Sound.
वेद सर, मैं स्टार्ट विद द वेबिनार नाउ.
या प्लीज स्टार्ट.
गुड आफ्टरनून, आई एम दीपक मिश्रा एंड ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ आई हेरा एंड जाइडस हेल्थ केयर आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू द सिक्स्थ एडिशन ऑफ सिंप्लीफाइंग एम्ब्रियोलॉजी. फॉर टुडेज सेशन वी हैव टू वंडरफुल कोऑर्डिनेटर्स, डॉक्टर चारुदत्त जोशी एंड डॉक्टर वेद प्रकाश सर. अ ब्रीफ इंट्रो आई वुड लाइक टू, इट विल बी माई प्लेजर टू गिव. Dr. Charudatt Joshi, sir, is postgraduate in life sciences, has special training in ICSI IVF from Genk, Belgium, special training for embryo freezing from KK Women's Hospital, Singapore, done special training in laser assisted hatching from Belgium, done special training in PGD from Germany, done doctorate in life sciences in 2018. Executive committee member of MPSR and MPIFS both, past vice president and president of ACE, medical director of JAMS India ART Bank. Welcome Charudatt Joshi sir. Our second coordinator for today is none other than Dr. Ved Prakash sir. Sir is lab director of Southern Fertility and IVF Delhi NCR, Master in Biotechnology, trained in IVF and ICSI from Andrology and IVF Lab, KK Women's and Children Hospital, Singapore. Advanced IVF, ICSI and embryo biopsy training at AZVU, Brussels, Belgium. Vice President, Academy of Clinical Embryologists, India. Welcome, Ved sir.
Thank you.
Now I hand over the session to you, sir.
Thank you. Akash, can you please share the screen?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So on behalf of International Human Embryology Research Academy and Zydus Cadila, I welcome all of you. And today we are going to, our theme for this webinar is all about oocytes. So we will discuss about oocyte on day zero, how we, what are the problems, what are the situations we face, and how we can get good result from out of this. And second, there will be panel on embryo quality. This program will be around 1.5 hour. Today, we have three coordinator, Dr. Rahul Sen. He's a Chief Embryologist in Neelkanth Fertility, Jaipur, Executive Member, Academy of Clinical Embryologist, ACE India, Executive Member, ISAR, Rajasthan Chapter, IFS Rajasthan Chapter, and he has done organized many conferences. He is a member of ISAR, IFS, ACE ASHRAE, and he is a very good team leader in IHERA. Second is Dr. Sanket Dhumal. He is Senior Clinical Embryologist, Chama IVF Fertility and Reproductive Medicine Center, Department of Gynae. He is an Executive Member of ACE India, UA Team Leader IHERA. He is an Editorial Board Member of Journal JBRA Assisted Reproduction. He is a reviewer for four International Scopes Index Journal, GBRA, JHRS, JRHM and OGS. And authored few publications, and to his credit, author and co-author of three books chapter. He's a principal investigator for several projects at Chama Medical College. He's a member of ACE and ASHRAE, and regular faculty in various national and international conferences. Third is Dr. Ashok Agarwal. He's a MBBS ASHRAE certified clinical embryologist. He's a topper of 2019. He's a alumnus of Osmania Medical College, practicing male infertility and embryology since 2011, actively involved in academic and has co-authored a book chapter. He is an active member of National and International Fertility Organization, ASHRAE, ISAR, IFS, ACE. And now I think it is Dr. Akash is there.
Sir.
Akash, can you take over now?
Sure, sir.
Sure.
Thank you for the kind introduction, sir. I would like to now welcome Dr. Nandeshwar Patil and Dr. Sandeep Karnakaran. The topic would be evaluating the importance of day zero in an IVF cycle. She'll be giving a talk on that, and Dr. Nandeshwar Patil would be moderating it. Dr. Nandeshwar Patil is the Chief Clinical Embryologist at KLES Dr. Prabhakar Kore Hospital, Belgavi, Karnataka. He's an External Academic Committee Member for ICMR, National Institute of Traditional Medicine, Belgavi, and he's an Executive Committee Member of ISAR, Karnataka Chapter in Clinical Embryology. He's also a member of Board of Examination for Microbiology and Biotechnology of Karnataka University. He's an expert reviewer for ISO certification or IVF labs, National Skill Development Corporations, Healthcare Skill Council draft qualification packs, and he's a life member for ISAR and as well as the Karnataka chapter of ISAR and ACE India. So over to you, sir. Sir Patil, sir, you are here, sir? So, wait, sir, I think Patil sir is not here, Dr.
Sir is there. He is on mute. I'll ask him.
Please.
Patil sir, if you can hear us, please unmute yourself.
Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, now you, it was unmuted.
Yes, sir. Thank you. So you can introduce Sandeep sir, and he'll take
questions. Yes, sure. Okay, I'm very happy to introduce Dr. Sandeep Karunakaran. He's a reproductive medicine specialist, and he's presently affiliated with Banjara Hills Oasis Fertility as a clinical head and senior consultant. And he served in the Indian Army as a gynecologist and fertility specialist for 25 years. And he's headed ART centers like AHRR, Naval Hospital, and Air Force Command Hospital. He's been honored with the Chief of Army Staff Commendation for his meritorious services. And he's a professor and examiner for obstetric OBG and reproductive medicine. And he led the team which performed the first ovarian cortex transplantation of the country in a case of malignancy. And now Dr. Sandeep Karunakaran will speak on evaluating the importance of day zero in an IVF cycle. Over to Dr. Sandeep Karunakaran.
Is the screen visible?
Yes, sir. Okay.
The 6th of June, 1944. I mean, it's a very important day, but not for embryologists, all clinicians for that matter. But the entire world changed when this happened. A lot of planning happened to land a huge amount of troops on the seacoast of France. Many countries were involved. The Air Force was primarily responsible for dropping a lot of ammunition and men. The men came in hordes. The Navy bought troops in hordes. The infantry were stationed in the boats of the Navy, and they landed on the beach of Normandy. When all of this got together, the Nazi regime fell. And hence, the critical day when this happened is called the D-Day. Today, I talk about the D-Day in our lives. What does it mean for an embryologist? What does it mean for a clinical person who's doing reproductive medicine? So I sit in front of you to evaluate the importance of day zero or the D-Day in an IVF cycle. A small point which actually missed out was my first love always has been embryology rather than clinical, and it's a pleasure to address the embryologists of the country through this forum. I'll go through this entire conversation as day minus one, the day zero, and the different scenarios that one has to face in our lives when this happens. Why day minus one? Day minus one is the time when we prepare, and we don't never go into any action without preparing. So day minus one also assumes equal responsibility or equal amount of importance. It's a day of anticipation, to say the least. There are a few things that we really need to look into. One is the OT list. And in the OT list, we must make sure as to what exactly is the oocyte number, the semen parameters, and the planning what has to be done on day minus one so that we have a clean and smooth day zero. So let's go into all these things one by one. Let's talk of the OT list. We all know what the OT list means. It is a list of cases along with the timings. It also tells us who is doing the surgery on that particular day and whose assistance would be. It also is a very important legal document because it has to be recorded in the hospital records, and if needed, it is pulled out in case of legal issues. It forms the basis of the entire planning of our IVF cycle. Let's go on to the next important thing, that is the oocyte number. It is possibly a pivot around which the entire day revolves. It is very, very important in the planning because based on this, we would be dispensing a lot of media. It also determines how much time is taken for the entire day. If there are more oocytes, ICSI takes longer time. We all know that. It also determines how many plates needs to be made for the cycle or for the IVF to be done. Also, it helps us allot slots in the incubator for the culturing plates. Next important thing happens to be the semen parameters. Why is it important? Because it determines how we are going to prepare the semen, whether it's going to be fresh or frozen, whether it's going to be ejaculate, or are we going to retrieve the sperms through a surgical procedure or called as SSR. And make sure that you have a backup sample on the day prior to the pickup day, or at least you will have some time to gather some amount of backup if you don't have one. So look into the parameters in the OT list of the patients who are coming to the next day, to your OT tomorrow, I mean the very next day. When you have all these things, you have to make a plan. You have to plan for how much media is required, how much disposables is required. Of course, all the media and disposables is entirely dependent on the SOP that is being followed in the organization that one is working in. Another important thing that one needs to really do is to plan the manpower. You have to plan your embryology team. You have to make sure that there is adequate amount of manpower to clean up the OT, clean up your lab, the support staff. All these things needs to be thought about a day prior rather than on the day of surgery. You also have to plan how much time is there between the cases. The clinicians do their pickup, they walk out of the OT. But we as embryologists, we have to work with the oocytes for a protracted period of time after the last egg has been delivered to us. It is always better that we whiteboard our plans, we distribute our duties on the board, on the wall. Now we come to the day zero. Well, on day zero, there are many things like parameter checks, media checks, plate checks, et cetera, et cetera. I'll be going through each and every one of this and try to elaborate on all these factors which I've enlisted here. But before I actually do that, let me clearly tell that if at all there are some pictures which I put, it is just for representation and I have no commercial or financial interest in any of the pictures that have been displayed in my screen. Parameter check is possibly the most important thing in the life of the embryologist. We wake up rather than, as I would have put it to my juniors or my under trainees, it is equivalent to brushing your teeth. You cannot get on to the day without doing a parameter check. You have to check the temperature, the CO2 levels in your incubator, the pH check as per your SOP, what is the humidity in. Check everything that needs to be checked. And there are certain things which has to be checked daily. There are certain things according to SOP which needs to be checked around 3 days later or every 3 days. And there are certain things which needs to be checked weekly. There are certain things that needs to be checked monthly. Your day has to start with this parameter check, or also popularly called as QC or quality control. Next is the media that you have dispensed the previous evening. Recheck it, check the color. Some of the media do have a phenol red indicator. You will know whether of course it comes with experience, whether the color has changed appropriately or the color has changed adversely. Make sure the pH is good if you do it on a regular basis, or if it's done on an alternate day or a weekly basis, do as per your set protocol in your lab. Make sure the gas supply is adequate and proper flow. Make sure the cylinders are in pristine conditions and adequately quantified or full. The next thing is to make the place. That's the first thing that we generally do when we enter the lab, depending on the case. Make, and most important, label if possible. It is good to have the witness, to get the witnessing done at this very point of time, depending on your system of witnessing. Needless to say, the appropriate plates which need oil cover should be done at the earliest so that the media is equilibrated at the before the critical eggs and sperms are put into it. It is, as I said, the very best to prepare the plates before the surgery starts, because once the surgery starts, there's going to be tremendous amount of movement in the lab and the particulate matter will definitely increase. So it is prudent to do it at the earliest when the day begins. Allocate which patient is going to which side of the incubator before the case starts. It will help easy flow in your lab. After this is done, it is prudent to just go outside and reconfirm this. Once in a while, we might end up with a cancellation. Take an attendance like one of the class teachers does of all the patients. Make sure it's both the male as well as the female is present on the day of pickup. Check the case sheets again, check for consents, check the gamete numbers once more. Make sure there is no variation between the actual case sheet and the OT list.
I think because of some network fluctuation, Sandeep sir has logged out.
Yeah.
Please remain here. I'll try to reconnect with him.
Mm-hmm.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, Max, sir. Yeah.
Sorry, the power failed, so I just got a little cut off. No, I'm just sharing my screen again.
Sure.
Visible?
Yeah, visible, sir.
Yeah, I'll just get it.
Okay.
Yeah, so we were here. I think this part was done, if I'm not wrong. Okay, I'll go through this slide again. Of course, we have to reconfirm the list on the day of surgery. Make sure there are no cancellations. Make sure that the patient is attending. I mean, in the sense, you have to almost be like a class teacher and take the attendance of the patient. Make sure both the male and the female partners are present. Check the case sheet. Check the gamete numbers. I mean, are they corresponding to the list as per the that has been provided to you? Okay. The next, possibly the most important step, is the ID check. Always before the surgery, check the patient's ID. It's prudent to do it with a photo ID, and it is prudent to do it at every point of the procedure or the day, at the entry when the patient actually enters the operation theater, on the OT table, when the sample has been collected, and during every procedure, be it the ovum pickup or the embryo transfer, whatever happens, one has to do this ID check at every given point in time. Also, once this is done, once the manpower is checked, check the equipment. A QC generally would mean that your equipments have been checked, but look for any leaks, any oil leaks, any abnormal smells, check all your light sources. I mean, switch on the microscope lights, switch it off. We look at the purification system. Most of them do have indicators, showing the particulate level as well as the VOC level. Peep into the OT instruments also, because ultimately the responsibility will be on the lab director oblique. It's always a collective responsibility. I don't think the clinicians are from a different country or a different team per se. Check that the OPU suction pump is working, the oven pickup suction pump is working. Touch the test tube warmer, which is kept on the near the OT table. Once all this is done, then check your manpower. Make sure the number of embryologists are present in adequate number for the number of cases that day. Make sure the assistant to the apprentice to the embryologist is present. The andrologist, if not separate from the embryologist, need to be present. Say hello to your clinicians. Say hello to your anesthesiologist. They are very important people, especially anesthesiologists. And also make sure your support staff is definitely present. The support staff might be the background players, but they're as important as the foreground players as you can. Plan, and what do we do in the time between the cases? We should use it optimally. There is no doubt about it. We should, rather than rest and recoup, we should rest and rotate. A person who's been on the microscope for a long time can take a break and do a bit of andrology or vice versa. Make sure in between the cases, you clean up your system. Make sure the bench top, the bench is absolutely clean. In between cases, it is prudent to switch off the bulbs. It would help increase the longevity of the bulb. Also, make use of this time to complete your documentation. Good documentation always leads to better results. In between, also meet your clients. Explain the outcome, especially after the pickup has been done or the ICSI has been done. If there's a problem with the maturity, if the M2 numbers are less, please explain to clinicians. It's always good that the urologist talks to the patients, the real clients of yours. Talk amongst yourself, see if there is any scope of improvement. A team huddle on day zero always helps, once before the surgery starts and once after the surgery is done. Now I'll go into certain scenarios that we faced over the years and what if this thing happens. These are picked up from my personal lives and life and the life of a few seniors that I have been closely interacting with. First is if the patient doesn't reach on time. It's a very stressful situation because you know that the trigger is timed, the OM pickup is timed. Firstly, get some time and talk to the patients. Tell him that he or she is responsible for his case as much as you are, or possibly a little more. Document that event. Put it into his clinical notes. Put it into your embryology chart that the patient came in late. Tell him or her about the possible adverse effects of his wrongdoing. And at the same time, try to improve the efficiency of your steps. That is, if a junior person has been slated to do the oocyte segregation, make sure it is handed over to someone slightly senior. So it improves the timing of your steps. It would reduce the possible adverse effect that would be listed against the certain case. The second is, of course, most of us would have faced by now is collection issues. That is, if a person can't deliver semen. Most of the patients do respond to a bit of pep talk and telling that it is normal, it happens. Even if you can't deliver semen, go have a cup of tea, come back and try again for the semen collection. Mostly it would work. If it doesn't work, we do have tablets like sildenafil and tadalafil, which help people maintain an erection and deliver the semen sample. Electroejaculation is present in certain labs, but most of us wouldn't be aware of this. But it is always good to have a urologist who has electroejaculation on your phone list. Send the patient across to him, because you do have about 3 to 4 hours between the oocyte pickup and the ICSI. So if he has not been able to give the semen sample, send him across, get the ejaculated sample from the urologist. If nothing else works, you can always use the backup and reserve, and that is where it actually becomes imperative to make sure on day zero that we do have a backup and a reserve in our cryo tanks. If nothing works, of course, you have the surgical sperm retrieval by the way of TESA or PESA, or TESA or PESA is actually possible because you can do it under a small local anesthetic or a small GA. but of course it does have the risk of doing a sort of an emergency surgery. The last option, of course, is if a person, husband or the partner cannot deliver the semen sample, we can always vitrify the partner's oocytes. That happens to be the last, but of course it increases the cost factor of the cycle. The second issue is if it's a poor sample. You expected something fabulous, and what you get is possibly not as good. Of course, the best thing is to possibly repeat the sample. The second sample might be better than the first one. So you could still get back on, your plans would get back onto track. Of course, you also have the backup sample coming to your rescue once again. What you really need to do to get a poor sample is to modify your sperm prep adequately or suitably. Do it so that it suits the current sample that you have in hand. You might have to convert from conventional IVF to ICSI. Most of us do 100% ICSI, but I am a staunch believer of conventional IVF. So if at all, once in a while, you get a poor sample, you might have to shift gears to do ICSI rather than conventional IVF. And of course, if the sample is absolutely bad, you can still resort to the surgical sperm retrieval. What if the list is too crowded? I mean, sometimes it happens. Mondays is absolutely free. Tuesdays, you have 7 cases on the list. Well, you must plan ahead, increase your manpower. Rely on flowcharts. Make sure that everything is in a cyclical way and everyone knows his job on that particular day, on that particular event. And it is absolutely clear to everyone as to where he should be present or at that point of time. At this point, when the crowd is too much, it is good to delegate responsibilities rather than keeping every egg in one basket. Identify the bottlenecks. That is where the senior person has to be, at the bottleneck and trying to expedite things as they slow down. And we should prioritize the cruciality. What I mean is, a simple step can be delegated to a person who is slightly junior, but if a step is critical, it has to be taken on by a slightly senior person. Also, what I would suggest is to have a checklist dependency. What I mean by this, on a crowded day, have a checklist for all the patients and make sure you tick those boxes as you complete the procedure. By doing this, you will not miss a single step and the patients will have better results. Another issue that we sometimes face, and this is a clinical problem actually, is a spontaneous ovulation. It does happen once in a while. You think that you're controlling the HPO axis, but a man can only propose. The disposal is by God. So sometimes this does happen. You have to inform the patient that this has happened. Of course, at times if the patient is under anesthesia, inform the husband who might be waiting outside. Counsel whenever it is possible, at the earliest that is. Retrieve the rest of the eggs. And if your clinician is a little senior, a little more competent, we can actually retrieve the eggs also from the POD fluid. This also can be easily done, but one has to be careful so that you don't injure the adjoining gut. Another issue that we face at times is the resultant fluid gives no OCC or the oocyte cumulus complex. Pause the event. Check, is there any problem? Check if there is free cumulus present in the follicular fluid. Get a UPT done of the patient. Check the hormonal levels of the post-trigger values of the hormones if the clinic is doing one. After that, check the timing of the trigger. Ask the husband or the partner, has the patient taken the trigger on the correct time? If everything is okay, change the site. What I mean is, if you've been doing pickup from the right side, go on to the left. And once you do that, go for a representative follicle. Don't go for something which is about 25 millimeters in size or something which is 14 millimeters in size. Pick up something which is around 18 to 20 millimeters in size. That is what I mean by going for a representative follicle. Check again for the presence of cumulus and the eggs. If it works, continue with the ovum pickup. If it doesn't work, the most likely reason is possibly either a trigger failure or it's a receptor failure. Prudence would be to change the trigger and re-trigger and reschedule the case. Equipment failure. There are many equipments in our lab. We are so heavily equipment dependent. There could be, the most common ones, of course, are the suction failure, the heating failure, and of course, the bulb failure. I'll go through each and every one of them and how to possibly handle this. there are many, a plethora of suction pumps, and I think as embryologists and people who are continuously working in the lab, one should know what equipment the clinicians are using, because at times it is very, very stressful for the clinician. It's also, these are all mechanical things, equipment, which can be rectified by simple common sense. The first thing possibly is to check the vacuum circuit. Is it complete? Are there any leaks? If there are no leaks, purge the suction pressure. That is, slightly increase the pressure and keep on increasing it till the needle is cleared. This purging has to be done by gradual increase of pressure, which protects the oocyte. Flush the needle if possible. Change the needle, that's the next thing. And if possible, convert the single lumen to a double lumen, because flushing is possible simultaneously with aspiration. If there is heating equipment, failure, it's always good for us to keep alternatives or reserves. There is possible times when one needs to improvise the entire situation, wherein if the test tube warmer is not working, use a induction plate, in the kitchen, or the heating plate to use as the heating device for a test tube. There are many times this happens. Have spares, and it's not only adequate to have spares, but you should know how to change. I do have a couple of photographs when I was doing, this was in Bombay around, I think it was about 5-6 years back. The bulb had failed. There's nothing exceptional in this photograph except that area. I didn't have a spare bulb, so I removed the entire equipment, the lighting part, and used a torch to complete the procedure. Strings, that is the cello, the double bass, and the violin, along with the brass of the cymbal and the triangle, the percussions of the drums, the wind instruments like flutes and the trumpet, and the showstoppers, the piano, all come together to form an orchestra. But they really form a good orchestra under the guidance of the conductor. The conductor is the pivot around which the orchestra revolves. And similarly, on day zero, the embryology team leader is the pivot around which the entire success of the IVF cycle would revolve. I have tried to put my points across to you in a way, not from books, but from personal experience. I bet there might be a bit of questions, and I do thank you and express my gratitude for listening through my talk, and I would welcome questions if at all there are any. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Sandeep Karanakaran. You all nicely covered the practical aspects of, the day-to-day prerequisites. Along with the day zero, you have covered very nicely day minus, what all the embryologists should know.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Over to Akash.
I think there are some questions in the chat box. Shall I take them on, sir?
Yes, sir. There's a question about the normal insemination range, sir, and what are the likely causes of polyspermia?
I'll start with the normal insemination range. Generally, it is said, let's talk about the WHO standards. Up to 15 million and plus is considered normal. Up to beyond 10 to 15, we generally prefer IUI. Anything less than 10 million, we would rather prefer conventional IVF till about 1 million, that is 1 to 10 million. Anything less than 1 million is what is going to convert the cycle into an ICSI cycle. But notwithstanding that, there are going to be a lot of factors. What is the normal amount of percentage of normal forms present? What is the motility? What I mean actually is you should have at least about 50 to 60,000 per droplet of per oocyte of sperms present to do a conventional IVF cycle. If it is less than that, the fertilization percentage is definitely going to be hampered, and it would be prudent to move on to a ICSI cycle. Likely causes of polyspermia, of course, one has injected two sperms instead of one, that definitely happens. But generally, these are all genetic factors, if I'm not wrong.
Thank you, sir.
Charudat sir has already answered that question.
Yes, sir. So we'll take on any other questions, sir, after the second session, sir, if anything comes.
Definitely.
And we'll be moving on to our next topic. And
Deepak, can you check? Dr. Surita is there?
Yes, sir. She has joined, sir.
Joined? Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. She has joined.
So I would like to invite Dr. K.D. Nair, sir, and Dr. Surita Karim for the next topic, which would be the number of oocytes required in a successful IVF program. Dr. Nayasar is a senior consultant HOD of Akanksha IVF Center at New Delhi. He is the president-elect of IFS 2022-2022. He has held various posts in IFS, including the secretary general and as a convener for the educational committee. And he has been the chairman of various departments. Sir has multiple international presentations to his credit, including 28 ASRM and 19 at ESHRE. So over to you, sir.
Thank you. I must thank Dr. Ved Prakash for inviting me for this embryology meet. It is my pleasure to be here. And the next speaker is going to be Dr. Surita Karim. She is currently the president of Gorakhpur Ops and Gynae Society. And she has served as secretary Gorakhpur OB-GYN Society in 2003 to 2005 and organized the first live workshop on NDVH at Star Hospital and first live workshop on laparoscopy and hysteroscopy at UPCOG Gorakhpur. She has been trained in AIT and IVF at Medical Fertility School, Bombay, and started the first successful IVF center in Gorakhpur since 2005. She has been trained in laparoscopy and hysteroscopy in 1998 from Frankfurt, Germany. And she has been the librarian in the UP chapter of ISAR. She was member of the executive committee of UP chapter IFS. She is regularly organizing hands-on laparoscopy training for doctors at Star Hospital. And she is presently president of the Inner Wheel Club Gorakhpur, a wing of the Rotary International. She has always taken interest in cultural activities and is currently chairperson of Gorakhpur chapter of Society for Promotion of Music and Culture Among the Youth. Dr. Surita, please welcome.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nair, for such a kind introduction. And I am very sorry that I have joined a little late. One thing is that I am having some problem sharing my slides. So can the whoever is in charge of the webinar kindly help me out with that?
Is your presentation up, ma'am?
Yes, my presentation is there on my laptop. So
can you please send us, ma'am, can you please email us, or maybe you can send us on WhatsApp if it is possible?
The email ID, can you tell me,
ma'am? It is info IHERA at gmail.com.
Akash?
Yes,
sir. While I'm sending it across, and meanwhile, I can start a little bit talking about the minimum number of eggs with the permission of Dr. Nair.
Yes, ma'am.
Because whatever we are doing in IVF is a learning curve for all of us throughout however many years we may have done it in our settings. But every year we are learning more and more. And as a clinician and as a person running an IVF setup, I can say that it is a very vital part of the whole IVF procedure to harvest a good number of eggs. Eggs are the bedrock on which the whole success of the IVF program runs. So according to the literature, what we have understood so far is that it is not the number of eggs which are important, but rather it is the quality of eggs which is going to help us to get a good birth rate, live birth rate. I am sure all of you will agree with me. A lot of times we take out a large number of eggs, maybe 17, 18 or so, and some of them are so poor quality then that when the final embryo we see on the day 3, then we feel that, oh, it has been a futile exercise. And there are a lot of things as a clinician I have to point out that is important while stimulating a patient, which are actually going to make a impact on the number of eggs that we have. So the most important thing is, while taking up a patient for stimulation, it is the age of the patient, the biophysical profile of the patient, her professional career choices that she has made, and of course her BMI. These are the few important things which can help us, you know, decide on the protocol. And then finally, when we take a detailed history of the patient, some of the important things which are very, very important, like we have to see if she's got a tendency for hirsutism and she's a PCO case, or she's a professional in the IT field where she is going to have to work long nights and has a lot of stress. So the stress factor has to come down. And if she is addicted to smoking. So if she is addicted to smoking, again, the tobacco and the smoking, and even in the from the rural areas, because I am practicing at a rural center, you can say it's a semi-urban kind of a setup. So it is not only the tobacco or the cigarettes which are harmful, it is also the kachi surti which these people take, the tobacco chewing habits of the women as well as the men, which impact the oocyte quality. So the bedrock...
मैम एक्सक्यूज मी मैम भेज दिया आपने yeah. आई नहीं है मैम अभी
या yeah, भेज दिया है स्टार हॉस्पिटल के उससे आ गया है चला गया है
स्टार हॉस्पिटल ठीक है लेट मी चेक
सो बेडरॉक ऑफ द होल प्रोग्राम इज द ऊसाइट क्वालिटी सो द एंटायर एक्सरसाइज इज दैट इफ वी हैव टू स्टिमुलेट द पेशेंट वी मस्ट अंडरस्टैंड दैट हाउ टू वी गेट द गुड क्वालिटी ऑफ ऊसाइट्स. So the minimum number which we are looking at in a patient is about, say, between 5 to 15. So 5 to 15 is our range of eggs, where we say that if we get a number of eggs is between 5 to 15, we may have a good result. So at the lower end of the spectrum is the 5 eggs. At the higher end of the spectrum is the 15 eggs, oocytes. So if we have a... If we have a person, patient who has yielded only 5 oocytes, so there is no need to be very, you know, upset about the whole scenario. I'm talking to all my youngster colleagues who may have been getting these kind of patients. And sometimes you are having only 4 or 5 eggs in the dish and you don't know what to do with it and how to go about it. Has it come, Mr. Ved Prakash?
Kone matlab?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. This is it. So once we, will you be taking it? How do I get the screen sharing? Ye de hai unko, mil gaya hai. So once we have at least 5 eggs is the minimum that we can say that it will yield some embryos, at least 2 or 3 embryos, which we can think of implanting in that same cycle. Or maybe we can freeze and implant in the second cycle. So the quality again is the bedrock of the whole exercise, and the quality is something which we need to focus upon. Are you putting up the slides, whoever is in charge? Dr. Ved Prakash?
We have just received, ma'am. We are doing it. It will take a couple of minutes.
Okay. So apart from the quality, the most frequent question we are asked is that if we have got, say, around 17 or 18 eggs, suppose we have a very high number of eggs, how much do we require to... How much do we require to actually get the good number of embryos? So I would say that once we check, yeah, I think now my slides are coming up on screen. So as So when we start the stimulation, like I said before, the every woman will yield a different kind of a oocyte quality as well as quantity. However, our aim is to standardize the protocol so that we get at least a minimum number of 5 to 12 eggs. And in my center, we focus on at least getting 10 to 12 oocytes from each patient. However, if the ovarian reserve is low and we are doing a minimal stimulation program, then we aim to get maybe 4 or 5 eggs, and then we do oocytes, and then we do the ICSI program so that we get a good number of fertilized embryos. So the amount, apart from the history taking and apart from the age and the calculation of the BMI and standardizing the protocol as far as the stimulation is concerned, once we hand over the oocytes to the embryologist and the embryologist has the final say on the maturation and what kind of the oocytes are there, I would say in a good lab with a good embryologist, a yield of 5 to 7 eggs or 7 to 10 eggs, oocytes, gives a fairly comfortable scenario for the clinician as well as for the embryologist. And we can say very safely that if we have a good fertilization rate, then we will be at the end of the cycle, we will be at least having 5 or 6 embryos in our hand. So the data suggests that IVF cycles which are stimulated with a long protocol, and especially if the patient is a PCO patient, the optimal number of oocytes for achieving a live birth is somewhere between 6 to 15. And the balance between the maximum treatment success and the, we have to balance these cases so that at the same time, while we get a maximum number of oocytes from this patient, we are also not exposing her to the risk of ovarian hyperstimulation. And therein lies the skill of the clinician, and therein lies the success of the center, that whilst doing the stimulation, you can change the protocol midway if you're seeing too many stimulations happen, too much of the oocytes exaggerated response, or you can coast a bit, or you can do the oocyte preservation in that cycle and maybe embryo making the embryo later on. And similarly, we do a finer tuning of the whole cycle so that when we end up with the cycle, we at least the lady has 5 or 6 embryos in the freezer. And that is what makes a good successful IVF program run comfortably. Are we getting the slides or not? I'm not too sure.
The slides are visible, ma'am.
Okay. So we can go on to the next slide. Do I have the control of that?
No, ma'am. I think Akash, sir.
Ma'am, you can, is this the slide you want, ma'am, or the next slide?
Next one.
Next one?
Yeah. Okay. Same, this one, yeah.
Okay.
So below 36 years in our program, we have got live birth rates even with 3 to 8 eggs, maybe 4 eggs. And however, we feel more comfortable when the egg number is between 6 to 10. Then we can say that, yes, we will get at least 3 or 4 good quality embryos. However, if we have the older women who are coming into the cycle and who do not want to go into donor programs and they have low reserves, so there we do the stimulation in an antagonist protocol or a natural cycle protocol. And between 38 to 40 and 41 to 42 year old have a low live birth rate, no doubt. However, the thing is that what I repeatedly tell to my patients is that for the patient, it is not 10% or 5%, it is a 0% or 100%. And when they get a baby with a yield of 2 or 3 oocytes only, the happiness has to be seen to be believed, that when we are all so hopeless in the lab and in the clinic that she has got only 3 oocytes, how we will have the embryo. But single embryo transfers in such patients with blastocysts have always given us good pregnancy rates and good live birth rates. And so there is no need to be concerned even if the 41-year-old has given only 2 or 3 eggs. if the oocyte quality is good, you can hope and do a ICSI and get a embryo with that. Next. Next slide, please. So the researchers have analyzed thousands of IVF cycles and created a model based on age, number of eggs retrieved, and success rate. And they found out that 15 was the magic number. And this is again because what I was talking about earlier is that women who produce too many eggs may have poor oocyte quality. And those who have too few eggs might not have enough of the high quality eggs. So the oocyte quality is a parameter which keeps changing from oocyte to oocyte. In the similar cycle, we may have 3 oocytes with good quality and 6 maybe with poor quality. And that is why it is not a very, you should not predict to the patient on the basis of the ultrasound picture that if you are seeing at least 17 to 18 good number of follicles, but the girl is a very heavy smoker, has been a heavy smoker, or is very obese, or having hypothyroidism, you should not be very overconfident in predicting your success rate, because if the scan is showing a good quality, because it's a very frequent question what the patients ask, madam, eggs theek dikh rahe hai na? That is a very frequent question, I'm telling you, with the IVF patients. So, dikh rahe hain aur mil rahe hain, mein bada farak hai. So, that is, next please. That is what I would like to emphasize, is that this is a thing which is often ignored in the clinics, often not asked. And it is a very, very frequent practice amongst the youngsters, the millennials, who are now coming for IVF as soon as they are ready to start a family. They want to go for IVF because they feel it's a sure shot thing. My ovaries are fine. I have not had too much of exposure to stimulations. And so I will give good quality eggs. But the thing is that smoking can cause both long and short term problems with achieving pregnancy. Even with a natural cycle pregnancy, smoking is a problem. And there is good evidence to show that smoking over a long period of time causes irreversible ovarian damage, resulting in fewer eggs as well as low quality eggs, even after the smoking has been stopped. And even if you are a passive smoker, I would say, even that harms the oocyte quality. So the first thing when a patient is taken up for the IVF cycle, as soon as she is recruited, she has to be told about the bad effects of smoking, and active as well as passive smoking has to be stopped. And only then we can hope for a good quality oocyte. Next, please. Smoking damages the genetic material. It causes the hypochondrial changes and in eggs and sperm, and miscarriage of the offsprings and in birth defects rates are higher among patients who smoke. This has been proven time and again over a lot of studies in the international journals. Next. So I think we have run all the slides. And so basically, my take-home message would be to everybody is that whenever you're recruiting the women, please take a proper history of the smoking and the age, which is very important. And apart from that, if you have a high BMI, exercise can often give you good results in terms of improving the oocyte quality. And it is not the number, it is the quality of the oocyte which ultimately makes a difference in your live birth rates. And an optimum number, if anybody would ask me, is between 5 to 15. Optimum, I would say, is even in the higher age group, it can be 8. In a younger age group, it can be 12 to 15. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Sarita. It was a wonderful description. If any audience has any questions,
Dr. Nair, if you would like to add something, you please
I understand what you have been talking about, and you were basically talking in terms of a long agonist protocol when you're looking for between 5 to 15 two sides. But things have changed now. Recently, the things have changed dramatically. This 15 Usaid concept was given in 2010 or 11 by Sankara. But now things have changed. They say you stimulate a patient with antagonist protocol, generate as many Usaid as possible, give a agonist trigger, freeze them, use the frozen Usaid in the next subsequent 3 or 4 cycle. They are no more talking of a pregnancy rate or clinical pregnancy rate. Now we are defining the success of IVF as a cumulative pregnancy rate. That you do one pickup, you collect the number of eggs, collect the number of oocytes, create the embryos, freeze them, and transfer them one by one in a subsequent IVF cycles. You can do one fresh embryo transfer followed by 3 or 4 frozen embryo transfer. You calculate that is the cumulative pregnancy rate. That is the
I totally agree with you, sir, because the topic that was given was the minimum number of oocytes to, the minimum number we were talking about. But of course, the first cycle is the best cycle to stimulate. And as we all know, we do the best in the first cycle, collect as many oocytes and then make as many embryos as possible. And as you rightly said, we transfer one or two at a time. Yeah.
Because it was also information for me. I had to speak in our annual conference. It was my oration. When I was searching the literature, I found out that now they have shifted to the maximum number of oocytes. You stimulate, create oocytes, take them out, freeze the embryos, then transfer in a subsequent cycles. So you increase the cumulative pregnancy rate. That is what we are looking for. Anybody else want to comment?
I think there is one question from Dr. Khandwala. What is your take on re-triggering after empty follicles?
What is your
take on re-trigger after empty follicles?
I think what they mean is when you start collecting, you initially get 2 or 3 empty follicles. Then what would be your take on re-triggering it and on when to post the next pickup for them?
What we do is we give a dual trigger, then again we give a trigger and again collect in the after, say, 8 to 10 hours later, we try and do a repeat collection. If we are not cancelling it altogether.
You had any success with it, personal experience, ma'am? I would like to.
Never. I have not yet got. Because usually what we used to feel that maybe the quality of the HCG was not good enough, or maybe the patient had not taken the injection properly. So usually I have never, when we did the next pickup, we have not got any. I mean, I don't remember that we have got.
Dr. Surita, you see, it all depends what the trigger was given. If a agonist trigger was given, you check for serum progesterone level. If an HCG trigger was given, you check for beta HCG level. So this hormone level can give you whether the patient has taken the trigger or not. If you find the patient has not taken the trigger, then you have to re-trigger it. If initially the agonist trigger was given, then the re-trigger has to be HCG.
Yes.
In the same cycle. Once you give the trigger, then you do ovum pickup, same like before, after 36 hours. You don't start collecting up to 8 to 10 hours. You have to wait for the second trigger to act on the oocyte, so that you collect it after 36 hours. And we have been able to retrieve few cases. We have retrieved eggs. We have achieved pregnancy also. We have presented this paper in Asia also, the empty follicle. So you can, it's not that hopeless that if you got an empty follicle, nothing can be done. No, you can still achieve something.
We tried to do that HCG. We did the HCG and saw that the HCG, we had to repeat the HCG. But we did not get any oocytes from that cycle when we did a repeat pickup. So that was my experience in a way.
Yeah,
I think Dr. Vandana Bhatia is there. I think she can speak something about that. Dr. Vandana, can you tell us something about this? Because I think we have done so many cases with that.
Yeah, you said lot of cases.
Yeah. We have also done these kind of cases and we got result also. And generally what we are doing when empty follicles are coming continuously, then we stop that cycle and give trigger of SCG. And in 24 hours next day, we did the oocyte retrieval. And we got oocytes also and achieve pregnancy out of them. So Dr. Vandana, are you there? Dr. Vandana.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, please.
Yes, sir. What Dr. Ved is saying is correct, that we have had cases where we have had empty follicles and we have done and given a repeat trigger at that time and collected, done a pickup again after 24 hours, and we have achieved one pregnancy out of that. And we have been able to retrieve eggs also. So now it has become a protocol in our center that after 12 hours of the trigger, whatever we are giving, we definitely do, if we are giving an Ovitril trigger, we are doing HCG levels. And if we are giving a Decapeptyl trigger, we are doing LH levels after 12 hours to see where we are.
Mm-hmm. Good. That's a good point, yeah.
Yeah. That acts as a safety. That you are given the trigger and you are sure that patient has received the trigger.
Yes. I think now there is no question left here. No. Akash, is there any question now? Akash?
No, sir. There's one more question that's related to FET. If you can take that.
Please.
There's a... Why is endometrial synchronization being asked important for success of FET? This is by Harsh Mangera.
Sir, would you like to take that question?
Yeah, I couldn't get the question. What is the question?
Mr. Harsh Mangera has asked, why is endometrial synchronization important for success of an FET cycle?
You see, frozen embryo, you have frozen the embryo either at day 3 or you are frozen at a blastocyst stage. And once you are going to do a frozen embryo transfer, you are going to give a patient certain days of estrogen to prime up the endometrium. And then you will add progesterone to stimulate the receptors in the lining. Now, according to this state of embryo you are frozen, you in our center, like we are doing, the day we start progesterone, that is day 0. Then you give progesterone day 1, day 2, day 3, and then you can do a cleavage stage embryo transfer. If you have done a frozen embryo transfer, you have to give 1 day extra progesterone. Until unless you give this progesterone for such a minimum number of days, the receptor won't be there. So that is the issue. So you have to synchronize the endometrium with the stage of embryo you are planning to transfer. You simply cannot just take out the embryo and put it in the uterus. No. Your endometrium has to be primed, has to be receptive for this embryo. Like what is happening in a natural cycle when there is a estrogen followed by progesterone. The same thing we are creating in a FET cycle.
So say the LH surge in a natural cycle is detected on Monday, if it's not a HRT cycle and a natural cycle for an FET. So, and LH surge is detected on Monday. So what would be the ideal day for a day 5 FET?
You see, once you detect a LH surge in a natural cycle, then this progesterone is already going to be there from the time of LH surge. Progesterone will be already starting there. So if you want to do a blastocyst transfer, you have to give at least 5 days period.
5 days, I will also say that, yeah.
So what about the cleavage stage embryos? Are you giving 3 days of progesterone for a day 3 transfer? And have you found any difference if you are giving progesterone for 5 days for a day 3 transfer versus giving progesterone for a 3 days and then transferring on fourth day?
You see, generally speaking, for a day 3 embryo transfer, we give progesterone for basically for 4 days. In the sense, the day we start progesterone, that is day 0.
Okay.
Then we give day one, day two, day three, then we do the transfer.
Day three, that means you are giving 4 days of progesterone and doing a fifth day transfer. That means for a blastocyst transfer, you would be giving 6 days of progesterone and then doing a seventh day.
And we have found out many times out of compulsion, patient is not available, patient doesn't want embryo transfer on a particular day. You have to keep on shifting the day of embryo transfer. And whether you do kidney transfer on day six, or you do blastocyst transfer on day three or day four, you still achieve pregnancy. Because we don't know what is happening inside.
That's exactly what I wanted to ask. We
don't really don't know. We are depending upon ERA. We claim that we do ERA. This is for the next year. This ERA is going to stand. No, it doesn't stand. Yes. That is the issue. ERA, if you don't have ERA, it doesn't stand for next 3 years.
Very true.
Receptivity or non-receptivity doesn't stand. Yes. So we also don't know what is happening inside the uterus. So we have created this protocol, but according to the need of the lab, according to the need of the patient, you can change here and there and still achieve pregnancy.
Correct. Thank you, sir.
I think it was a very nice discussion. we will continue like that. So Akash, I think we can move to for panel also now.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
After,
thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. And thank you, Dr. Vandana.
Thank you, Dr. Ved Prakash and Dr. K.D. Nair. Thank you so much. Thanks.
Purita, ma'am. And thank you to Nandeshwar Patil, sir, as well as Sandeep Karnakar, sir, for the earlier wonderful lectures. And we'll be moving on to the next part of the session, which would be the panel discussion. And I would like to invite Dr. Rahul Sen to do the introduction and take on from over here.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. Akash, can you please share the screen? Yes. On behalf of IERA, I would like to welcome you all for this wonderful academic webinar. So moving ahead with the next session, I would like to call upon the moderator of the session. She is Dr. Charulata Chatterjee, Senior Consultant Embryologist from Hyderabad. She is very renowned embryologist, needs no introduction. Ma'am has already done total 26 years of experience in medical diagnostic and ART. She is a top class experience holder and doing embryology since last 20 years. He's Dr. Keshav Malhotra, again, very renowned personality in embryology. He holds a master's degree in clinical embryology, is one of the few ASHRAE certified clinical embryologists from India. He's the lab director from Rainbow Hospital, Agra. Dr. Malhotra is one of the board members of ISAR and ISPAT, and he worked on one of the key projects pertaining to embryology in the country, like occupational standard for embryologists and holding the embryology consensus. Over to you guys.
Thank you, Rahul, for that kind introduction. Are you going to introduce the chairs as well?
I think you can introduce the panelists.
So do we have Dr. Manish Bankar with us?
No, he's not with us at the moment.
Okay, so a very good evening to all of you. We have a fantastic panel planned. Thank you to Charu ma'am for being the co-moderator for this session. She's worked very hard on it. I'll be very honest. I did not have much time for this presentation. So all thanks to Charu ma'am. So we were supposed to have Dr. Manish Bankar here, but since he's not here, we can move on to the next panelist. We have Dr. Alex Verghese. We all know Alex, sir. He's a fantastic embryologist. He's done so many activities and he's so academically oriented. I think he needs no more introduction. We all follow him thoroughly. So thank you, Alex, sir, for joining us. We also have Dr. Shubhangi Gangal. She's done her postgraduate diploma in psychological counseling from IIC Delhi. She has a PhD. She's also done a master's in science. Lots of training in embryology from CREST, even from Italy. And she's been practicing embryology for the last 2 decades. So a very warm welcome to you, Dr. Shubhangi. Dr. Charu, you want to introduce the next two?
Yeah, welcome Dr. Vandana Bhatia. She holds her MD degree and she's a consultant IVF in South End Fertility, New Delhi. And she has lots of achievements and awards for her things, Dr. Brigadier R.K. Sharma and all that. So welcome Dr. Vandana Bhatia for this panel discussion. We have Dr. Priya Selvaraj. I don't think she needs an introduction. But just to say that she is a clinical director of GG Hospital, Chennai. And she has a special interest in pre-implantation genetic screening and testing. And we do have Dr. Gaurav Majumdar with us. He has done his MSc in clinical embryology from Singapore. And he is a joint treasurer of ACE and executive member of IFS. And he is very academically active in a national forum and has been very kind enough to join us for this session today. So I welcome all the esteemed and experienced panelists for this wonderful discussion. And the topic of today is embryo quality and failed IVF. Where does success remains hidden? So what we have done is we have made some case scenarios so that we all have practical tips to have the better quality embryos and to have the good pregnancy rate. So without any delay, we'll start, Keshav.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, you can start with the introduction.
Yeah. So as we all know that the goal of IVF is not only to have the better fertilization rate or better blastocyst rate, but the ultimate goal of IVF is to have the pregnancy and the live healthy baby. And the contemporary goals of IVF is to reduce the number of embryo to be transferred. And meanwhile, we have to also maintain the high pregnancy rate. So that needs a optimal embryo selection. And we all know that implantation is, unique, complex procedure where we have a receptive endometrium and the good quality embryo. There should be dialogue between endometrium and the embryo, and then it will implant. And if it is implant, then the pregnancy continues. So in spite of having all the advancement in our ART, still we are struggling with the live birth rate because 70% of the embryo loss occurs at the implantation. So ultimately what we have is 30 to 40% live birth rate. So the goal is to how to increase that. And yeah. If you see that where we success lies. So there are two parameters. One is a clinical parameter and one is embryological parameter. So that will be, interesting quality of the oocytes or stimulation protocol, the patients and the quality of the gametes like oocyte quality and sperm quality, that is main. But the laboratory also, there are a number of factors to be controlled to have the better outcome. And we will discuss one of all them in our case scenario. So it is from the culture system, lab environment, gaze phase, and everything which comes into, there are more than, it says 200 factors which has to be, controlled for the better outcome. So we'll start with the first case scenario. Keshav, will you start or shall?
I'll start this. So what I've done in this presentation is that on the left side, I've written on the slide, which me and Charu ma'am would refer to. So we'll interact like that. And on the right side of the screen, I've put in names of the panelists. For them to actually answer those questions, but anyone of you can butt in at any point of time if you have a point to make, and just raise your hands or point on the screen. I'm going to be looking at all of you, so just raise your hands and I'll ask a question, and Charu ma'am will also follow the same. So this case scenario, we have a 37-year-old Gravida Zero patient who's presented for evaluation. Her clinical workup was entirely normal. FSH of 9 on day 3, good response to stimulation. This was her first IVF cycle. There were 3 embryos that were transferred and 3 embryos that were frozen. She did not conceive during the fresh or the frozen transfer cycle. Most importantly, in this scenario, the embryos were not great. And they were characterized by a slow division. They were characterized by poor cellular morphology and a significant amount of fragmentation. So we're going to start with Dr. Shubhangi and Dr. Priya first. When you see such a kind of a phenomena where you're seeing a lot of fragmentation, you're seeing like slow division, etc., what all points do you think like you need to check for such a patient? Dr. Shubhangi, and then I'll take Priya in.
Yeah. Okay. So first and foremost is I would like to say that slow growing embryos, how do you define them? So slow growing, according to me, doesn't mean anything. As long as you get an embryo, which is a blastocyst, on day 6, it can still be used for a fresh transfer or a frozen embryo transfer. Now, having said that, we all know that up to 4 to 8 cell stage, the genetic information from the mother is responsible. And later on, the embryonic genome takes over. So now, if this fails, the embryonic arrest can happen. And this could be largely, according to me, because of the stress which is caused by the culture conditions in the lab. So most importantly, I would like to see whether the culture conditions are optimal, and which includes the media, the incubator, essentially the display, the temperatures, all those things. And definitely the age of the patient. So if the woman's age is more, that is what we have seen in our studies, that with increase in age of the patient, woman's particularly age, the oocyte quality and the embryo morphology is not as good as compared to the patients who are lesser than 30 years of
Priya,
age.
Priya, I'd like to bring you in here. When you see such a phenomena, do you like immediately point out that it's because of egg factor or sperm factor? Or what would you do in this scenario? Or it could be the lab, it could be the stimulation. There's so many things.
It could be the patient herself, but you gave me a scenario where she's 37. So I'll first take the age as a pointer, number one. Second is, you told me that you're quite happy with an FSH of 9, but for me at 37 and day 3, a value of 9, I would also want an AFC. And how did the ovaries look during the menstrual phase? And also an AMH is missing. So if I have all this information, I would be able to tell a little bit more where the fault lies. And I'm presuming that there is no male factor, because otherwise you would have mentioned it. So that's one thing. And so for me, in this particular patient, even before I start off on her IVF, I would have pointed to her that her age, and if I had had any leads on the AFC and AMH as well, because an FSH of 9 is still borderline for me, and I will want her beforehand. So,
no, but let's say she's like a borderline responder. She's not a normal responder. At 37, we're not anyways expecting much, a large amount of eggs from her.
The number actually is quite a good number, I would say.
Yeah, exactly. And would you straight away go ahead and point that it's egg factor, or would you want to consider sperm factor here as well?
I will consider egg factor.
Egg factor most importantly.
Stimulation protocol. To, you know, there are multiple things as a clinician to think of. You can't leave out the stimulation protocol. You can't leave out the male factor. You can't leave out. But between the two, I would point out to an egg factor being a strong indicator of the outcomes in this particular case.
Gaurav wants to come in here. Gaurav, your views?
I just want to make a point with regards to the question. It's important to point out that since you've said that the embryo quality was poor, they were slow growing, they were fragmented.
Yeah.
So I don't think there is a valid case for transferring 3 embryos in the fresh cycle and 3 embryos in the frozen cycle. So that needs to be noted. There's absolutely no justification for transferring 3 poor quality embryos in the frozen cycle. So I'd rather would have cultured them and seen the true potential of these embryos to see if they form blastocysts, then take any further steps. So just that.
We do not transfer, we do not even freeze. We counsel and then just give the patient the choice. Yeah.
We shouldn't be freezing such embryos in the first place.
I would also like to add one more factor, Keshav. It is the maternal RNAs, which are found in the early embryos, which are involved in the cell division. So I would rather say that it is because of the oocytes mostly.
So coming
that
to,
the embryo quality.
Yeah, I agree with you.
So yeah.
It could be
at this age.
Sperm also, but it's impossible to determine that in the first cycle.
Absolutely. And this was the first cycle, surprisingly, at 37,
yeah,
without conception in our country. But we are seeing cases like that happening all over now. So coming to the main part of this whole webinar today is, should we really be transferring poor quality embryos?
Can I answer
Priya,
that?
Priya.
So first,
Priya, go ahead.
No. I was just going to say that with pertaining to the question now that you're asking and the previous case that you projected, everything is to do with counseling for the patient.
Counseling, absolutely.
And that these are the qualities of embryos available on day three, and that the results are going to be poor. But again, you know, you don't have to refuse, because poor quality have also given pregnancies. So it just depends. If you're able to counsel and tell the patient and give the choice to them in a good way, giving them the truth about what to expect where the result is concerned, I guess we should not discard immediately. But at the same time, you should tell them that if you really want proof that this is going to be poor quality and it's not going to grow, then you have to allow the choice of growing all the way to day five and determining how to transfer or what to transfer.
Bhangi, I'll bring you in here. If you have a good quality embryo and if you have another one which is of a poor quality, and you're thinking of doing like two embryo transfers, or the patient wants to transfer two embryos, would you advise against it or would you be for it?
Again, first important thing I would see is the age of the patient and the cycle number. So if she is young and if we have one very good quality embryo, there is no need to transfer the second bad quality embryo, I feel. And with regards to your previous question, whether poor quality embryos need to be transferred or not. See, if we have no choice, then we have to transfer. We cannot deny an embryo transfer for a patient. A proper detailed counseling of the outcomes and the percentage of success and detailed explaining things to them, I think we should go ahead and transfer, because finally, if we are doing a day three transfer, I would like to say that the fragmentation up to 20-25% is not necessarily a bad fragmentation, because we have seen that a lot of fragments are transient. They would be reabsorbed, you know. So fragmentations are quite deceptive in some cases. So only because of fragmentation, if you're considering the embryo to be a poor morphology, then I would not really agree to that. So, and what happens inside the embryo, the genetics, we really don't know. So sometimes the corrections can also occur later on.
Yeah.
So definitely no denying a transfer to a patient.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that very valid point. Charu ma'am, all yours.
Yeah. So Dr. Alex and Dr. Vandana, we would like to answer this for this case. 26 years old female, which has a regular ovulation cycle, but she has a failed 4 IUI cycles. The male counterpart is fine according to the WHO strict criteria. And the first IVF cycle has majority of the abnormal oocytes, which has shown in this pictures. She had one blast and we have transferred. She is pregnant, but I just want to ask that which oocyte abnormalities are negatively correlated with the outcomes. First, I'll ask Dr. Alex. Dr. Alex, are you there?
Yeah, please. Yeah, sorry for that. So there are cytoplasmic and extracytoplasmic anomalies. Some have been correlated with the outcome, but generally, I think if it is majority of those that have some kind of anomalies that might affect the overall outcome. Especially what we have seen is the central granularity, dense granularity, that has been correlated with the negative outcome. And recently we presented on paper and of this on ASRM 2 years back on the PV space heavy granularity. I would say because we are seeing that some patient having heavy granulation in the PV space, So we have seen that those kind of cohorts have a live birth rate only in the range of around 10% to maximum 15%. I'm not talking about, we have categorized into mild, moderate, and heavy grand variety. And the third aspect is the endoplasmic reticulum, the SCRO site, but there is a two schools of thought. Initially, people were thinking that can have some congenital anomalies, but recent papers are showing that it doesn't have much effect on the outcome, but one has to be very clear on that. And the recent, I think 2019, on a good paper came out on the transcriptomic analysis on such oocyte, and they have shown that there is a lot of downregulation of the genes of the cell cycle in those. So best way is that if you have a SCR oocyte, inject them, keep them separate, culture them to the blastocyst stage, and keep them separate in the cryo device. I think that would be better, yeah.
So according to the oocyte abnormality, the debris PVS, the centrally granular cytoplasm and SCR is negatively correlated with the outcome, right?
Yeah, and maybe some more are there, some more aspects also. There.
So actually it says that only 5% of oocytes collected eventually results in the live birth. And if you consider oocyte abnormality, any morphological abnormality like size, shape, or corona cumulus structure, change the negative outcome, Dr. Vandana?
Yes, it depends upon the morphological characteristics also. What is the size? What is the shape of the oocyte? Zona pellucida. And basically, it is the chromosomal aggregation during the first meiotic division, how it is there. And the abnormalities further leading into the, you know, the organelles, the mitochondria, and the ooplasmic abnormalities, they also negatively correlate with the outcome. So basically, it is the nucleus and the ooplasm which are faulty. And with the age, of course, the chromosomal abnormalities are bound to increase.
So can I ask Dr. Vanna a question here? So, ma'am, whenever you get a patient stimulated, what are the things that you ask the lab to provide you information upon as far as the egg quality is concerned? And how do you then counsel your patients based on those facts?
See, again, whenever the lab, Dr. Ved is there, whenever the lab is telling us about the poor egg quality, they are telling us about the shape of the oocyte or whether it was a degenerated oocyte, whether it was an immature oocyte, and what was the other morphological characteristics of that oocyte. So we have to counsel the patient regarding her future aspects and prospects of what. And we also take into consideration the other parameters like the patient profile, the age of the patient, the number of years, her previous history, whether she's had any miscarriages, what are her hormonal levels, her AMH, her AFC, and then taking into consideration what are the stimulation protocols and what next can we do for the patient, whether we can really improve the quality of the oocyte by changing the stimulation protocol or by giving her some therapies like antioxidant therapies for a few months before we embark on another IVF journey. At the same time, we have to, counsel her regarding a guarded prognosis if the other cycle can also lead to the similar result.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Vandana, for that insight. And I think if you categorically say about the classification of the oocytes, we can classify it as a morphological aspect, intracytoplasmic aspect, and extracytoplasmic aspect. So the morphological aspect, if you see that, if we see the fragmented polar body or a giant polar body or a giant oocyte, does it also affect the outcome, Dr. Gaurav?
Yeah. So we
yes, there is a strong correlation.
We don't inject oocytes with large polar bodies, and we don't inject giant oocytes because then they will lead to tetraploidy, and giant oocytes are actually two genomes which have merged into one. So these are the oocytes to steer clear of.
Yeah.
Shubhangi, you wanted to say something here. I saw that you have a comment that you wanted to make.
No, the comment was we had presented a paper and we had studied around 700 plus oocytes. So our conclusions were that CLCG, that is centrally located central granulation vacuoles, definitely negatively impacted the developmental potential. SCRs, oocytes with SCRs did grow well, but implantation didn't happen in them. Most of the oocytes which showed dysmorphism didn't survive the cryopreservation. That was the observations that we found. And SCRs essentially we thought was due to the depended, the SCRs in oocytes depended mostly on the gonadotropin doses and the duration for which the gonadotropins had been administered. Also, the genetic predisposition cannot be ignored. But SCRs were definitely more in those where the stimulations were, the gonadotropin doses were very high. We found a lot of SCRs in those.
The value is high than the SCR.
Yes. I don't agree with that because whenever we see SCRs, you don't see them across the board in all the oocytes. So there'll always be in a cohort of oocytes, a few eggs, one or two eggs here and there may have SCRs. And this is a matter of chance that we end up knowing that eggs have SCRs only if we are doing ICSI, for that case. In cases of doing a conventional insemination, anyways, you'll never be able to know whether there was a SCR in the oocyte or not. So it's very rare that every single oocyte across the board through and through will have an SCR.
No, but nobody's saying that. We all know that 30% of the oocytes could be abnormal. So the abnormality also is not very common. That also depends on the age of the patient. Older women we have seen have oocytes which are not very morphologically good looking. They would be granulated, but again, mild granulation, we didn't see any negative outcome on the developmental potential and the implantation also.
I have other observation where the central granularity is concerned when we are doing for such kind of oocytes, the formation or the funnel formation will take little longer to, you know, regain the shape. So do you have any kind of information or observation for such kind of oocytes? And what about the embryo development for such kind of oocytes where the channel is taking little longer time to have the spherical shape?
So essentially it is to do with the consistency of the ooplasm. So if it is not very consistent, then the injection canal doesn't happen that appropriately, I would say. That we have also observed. But CLCG oocytes, I really didn't find any difference in the injection canal. But in the embryo quality, we did find a lot of difference.
Alex, your comments on this?
It is something related to the central, endoplasmic reticulum. So even though we are seeing a lot of papers, because there is a lot of confusion the way the studies have been done. Because if you see the majority of the cohort having the SCR pattern, maybe that is one that you have to look into more seriously. Most of the studies, they looked into maximum maybe 70 patient or 100 patient maybe having a the cohort or not to who said having, but that is not going to have some effect on the final outcome. I think maybe more better control studies are required. And if it is a recurrent phenomenon, we have seen the recurrent phenomenon of SCR in some patient. And on second point I want to make is that nowadays a lot of donors, many centers are doing donor cycles. So this patient jump from one clinic to another in a 6 month time, they go to maybe 6 centers. To provide the eggs. And when they give it like that way, ultimately what you are getting may be the oocyte having a lot of granulation and the PV space debris. In some clinics, I have seen people reporting that kind of situation. That is, I think, very important in the Indian scenario. And the third thing I want to mention about the nuclear maturity of those sites. There was some good study from my NSRE, and they have shown that if the cohort is having more of a M1 or a GVU sites, the day three quality of the M2 also will be compromised. So I think the stimulation part as a KPI, I think one has to make sure that from the embryology side, how many M2 has been you get from the follicle that has been retrieved.
Priya has a point to make here. Priya, I'm going to get you in. You're saying that SCR oocytes perform better with ICSI. We don't really know about SCRs when we're doing IVF. So
Crosby, in a case where, like how Dr. Bindu has written in response to that, I had asked, I put on the comment, but if suppose you have a large cohort, you've chosen this case for conventional IVF, and then you have a large number of unfertilized oocytes, and then the next cycle you decide to go in for an ICSI, and then you observe. These are all observations only when you denude the oocytes, right? The actual morphology of the oocyte. So at that point, the questions will come: which kind of oocytes can predict close to normal pregnancy rates, or are completely aneuploid. So in that way, I think SCR and those that have perivitline space inclusions will probably be separate from the rest of the morphological descriptions that have been highlighted before. I think these two will give you a lower pregnancy rate, but they do go on to fertilize and cleave and form embryos.
Definitely, yeah.
Yeah? Do the seniors agree? Because I'm speaking from the... just observing in practice, that's what I'm trying to...
We are doing this now. We are segregating the eggs with SCRs.
Yeah.
They make blastocysts also. We've done PGS also on a lot of SCR blastocysts, and they've turned out to be euploid, but we just segregate them.
That's also, no, because in my practice, it's almost 90% ICSI. So, you know, I cannot but denude, and then when they denude and you see the morphology, you know, so then you start segregating and doing all that.
Yeah.
If I've had a practice where there's a lot of conventional IVF, then I wouldn't know. My observations wouldn't be this way.
That's us.
I wanted to ask a question to Dr. Vanna. I don't know if she's here. I can't see her. Charu ma'am, you want any more questions on oocyte factor?
No, not really. We'll go to next.
What's the worst eggs that can result in, like, what's your worst egg in any case scenario? Like, what would be the worst feature in an egg? We can ask this question to all of you.
The egg which is shown in the E picture.
Okay, this one.
With the large vacuole.
Yeah. I agree. So
that's your worst fear in when you're doing ICSI.
We won't do ICSI in this egg.
You won't do ICSI.
We will
see, vacuole is a fuel filled sac, right? So the moment you go near the vacuole while injecting, it might just burst open and the sperm would not be deposited in the ooplasm.
Especially a large vacuole like this.
Yeah.
So these are eggs that we will remove. We will not eat. Inject.
And also the K1, the CLCGs. I don't like those eggs also.
E, K and I are my, you know, non-favorites. E and K.
Yeah. E and K for me.
And I think the C egg is degenerated, is it?
Yeah, that's degenerated.
Yeah.
So
the C one, right?
We had for our clinic here was, do clinical stimulation protocols, once you have like eggs like these, and the embryologist goes and says that we have really bad eggs, do clinicians change the stimulation protocols in the next try? Priya, you want to take that?
Absolutely. I think a lot goes, like when you, like, I, again and again, I'm referring to the first clinical scenario that you put up, because, you know, when you don't find anything else in the woman and it's just an age factor and things, I would really try to look into the stimulation protocol as to why this kind of quality happened. And if I failed with one particular protocol of mine, the next cycle, I make sure I counsel the patient and tell them I'm going to change that as well in case I don't have any other pointers. So I do think stimulation protocols do have an effect in the absence of any other factor. And I'm going to exclude lab completely because you ought to have a good lab for handling tertiary, these kind of difficult cases. So I don't think that would be an effect. It's always the patient, her age factor, her clinical parameters, and her stimulation protocol.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we're going to move on to the next question now. We've discussed a little bit about the egg. Let's move on to a little bit about the sperm now. So this is for Priya and Dr. Shubhangi. So here we have a 36-year-old man, non-obstructive ASU, normal karyotype, wife, normal parameters, married life is 8 years. The thing is that we are offering surgical sperm collection here. So the first question is, would you want to do like a TESA, TESA or a microTESA, whatever it is, on the day of the pickup, or would you advise freezing a sample before the pickup?
Should I answer? Or? Yeah. Okay. So from a clinician's point, I just wanted some more information because this is karyotype rules out all other diagnosis, right? What about the hormone analysis?
Absolutely. Sorry, I'm asking. What's your hormone cutoff for such patients?
See, FSH, LH, serum testosterone. If I have these values, then I will be able to decide whether I want to take her through a stimulation cycle and, make her endure all of that and then do the PISA. Actually, we do PISA and TESI on that day. Or should I diagnose him first completely? And if we do have, by luck, any sort of retrieval, then the freezing thing is told to the patient. Because the hormones are not mentioned, I'll be finicky to tell you whether I will straight away stimulate the woman before this, because I really have to think about it. Because then what will happen is if I don't have a complete clinical picture of this man, then I wouldn't be able to do anything, and I cannot then that day when I have nil retrievals of kinds. I don't do micro TC, so I have to think practically. I can do an epididymal aspiration, I can do a testicular sperm extraction, but what can I promise? So hormonal analysis is missing here, which will guide me very well.
Let's say the FSH is borderline. It's around 8. LH is also in the normal parameters. In that scenario, would you want to go ahead and... Can she...
I think so. I will evaluate him. If you're giving me a borderline scenario...
Okay, I think we've lost Priya. Dr. Shubhangi, you want to take that question? Any of the other panelists? Gaurav, you want to bump in?
We will always like to do a diagnostic procedure first.
Okay.
And freeze, just to make sure that, because we are undertaking entire IVF cycle and we don't want any surprises on the day of OPU. So we'll definitely like to, in case we have a good yield of sperm in the diagnostic procedure, then we'll definitely freeze that. And we'll tell the patient that only if the survival is really poor, then we might need another TESA on the day of OPU.
Yeah. So in this kind of a scenario, if like most of the times we get non-motile sperm, so do you want to culture them and wait for some time to see for motility and then make a judgment, or are you with just...
In our laboratory, we use the theophylline, preparation. Okay. So we use that, we immediately see whether there's any, sometimes we get a lot of motile sperms also, even in testicular samples, but otherwise we just check their, potential for motility with theophylline and freeze.
Yeah. And like any difference, because you're freezing samples, so have you seen any difference between frozen and fresh?
No. If the survival is good, if post freezing, if the sperms, they get revived properly and we find nice motile sperms, then there is absolutely no difference.
Okay. So yeah, we also do the same. We also freeze samples. And like I've also, based on my personal experience, I don't see any difference between fresh and frozen. Alex, sir, you want to take this up? How do you, how would you want to process a sample from surgical sperm retrieval?
Sorry, I got cut off. I'm so sorry.
That's okay. We've moved on to the next question. I'll bring you in back. Like I'll bring you in a while.
So for the ICSI purpose, so if you have adequate number of sperms, so like if it is a micro teaser, we get more than maybe 50 to 60 dishes coming into the laboratory. That is being like in the, given in the picture on the top side, left side on. And this, so we tease it using that tuberculin syringe and the needle with the bending. And if it is adequate sperms are there, we go ahead with density gradient. And we don't go with the enzymatic dilution or in a kind of erythrocytolyzing, but we don't use that, those things. And if it is, the concentration is very low, very extremely low, what we do the centrifugation two times in a higher range, maybe 2000, then we get the pellet. Then we make a river for a fishing dish where we put this, the pellet or the sperms. Then we use a large diameter ICSI needle for fishing. So in that time, we don't add the oocytes. So we can go into that debris area. We can, by the time, I think since we add the theophylline, most of the sperms wake up and come to the shore of the river. Then from there, you can easily pick up. Then we go to the PVP. Then we add the oocytes, so denoted to oocyte. Then we go ahead. So this is a practice we are doing.
Shubhangi, you want to come in here? I see that you're raising your hand. You're muted. Priya.
Okay, we make a few dishes of ICSI where we call the spreading. You know, like Alex said, we call those long moats where you spread the sperm sample and we fish the sperms before and then we put them in the PVP. If they are immotile, I generally try and do the, with the injection needle, you know, you just try and twitch the tail. So if it is even pliable and slightly moves, you can feel it, you know, that the sperm is viable. But if you get that breadstick kind of movement, you know, you twitch the tail with the injection and it is flat, nothing happens to it, then we consider it as a non-viable sperm. So that is one very practical way of checking the, if they're twitching, well and good. And we have a few dishes ready. We collect the sperms and then we will remove the eggs and do the ICSI. So by and large, it's the same procedure that Alex follows is what we follow.
Thanks, Shubhangi. Charu ma'am, you want to ask something specific on these enzymatic procedures and erythrocyte lysing? I've never used it. I have no experience.
I have no experience.
This is long back, so I just wanted to know that anyone is using this base also, because
we've used it.
Is there in the?
We've used it and we've used collagenase also, but this was many years back. Before we use theophylline or pentoxifylline. So right. Now pentoxifylline or theophylline has made life very easy. So
very easy for everyone.
Truly.
Priya, I think I'm going to get you in here because I have a question from Dr. Bindu. She's mentioning that a main male hormonal assessment should also include inhibin B levels apart from FSH, LH and testosterone. Do you agree with that? You're muted.
Sorry. Can you hear? Yeah. So no, I don't perform an inhibin.
Okay.
Level. I just
solely relying on FSH, LH and testosterone and like borderline levels. I'm going to go back to that question. If you have borderline levels, let's say 8 or 9 of FSH, what do you counsel your patient?
See, what we can tell is, see, well, the good point is that his karyotype is normal. And then I'm assuming that the local exam, the testicular volume is fine. And then it's only these parameters that are borderline. I think I would counsel them to go ahead for a stimulation and prepare them for all the ifs and buts. You know, if we do retrieve, then this is what we're going to do. And we'll just process and then, you know, proceed to ICSI. not in the worst case scenario, then it will be an oocyte freezing, and then probably a biopsy will be taken and sent. And in the other scenario where all these parameters are not okay and it's a low testicular volume, I will counsel them and say, I want to work on the man first before stimulating her, in which case we'll have a reliable diagnosis to work on. And then we can decide in case whether we are going to be able to retrieve from you or not, or whether donor sperms could be an end decision. So that would be the way I would handle this.
Okay.
And,
I have another question from Nehal. I'll put this to Gaurav. And that actually, the slide is right there. She's asking, how do you check for survival in immotile Thor Tisa sperms?
So we have to see some amount of twitching or motility. That's the only way where we are certain that the sperm has. So we wait. We wait for theophylline to act, for the sperm to move, to twitch, or to move from point A to B. If not, then what Shubhangi mentioned, that's the last case, that's the last resort where you check for the, you know, the tail, the consistency of the tail. So if there is absolutely zero twitching and no signs of motility despite treatment with theophylline, then we go for the feel of the tail and we pick up sperms which have soft tails. As compared to tails which are rigid. So then we pick up the sperms with soft tails and inject them.
Do you prefer HOS here?
Oh, yes. That's a very good point, that if theophylline doesn't work, then the next resort, is HOS. Is HOS, and if there is curling of the tails, then that's good evidence that the membrane is intact. And we inject those sperms. And if nothing works, then probably we will go for, the touch technique.
Yeah.
That's the one doubt that I had that I wanted to ask, whether you use the host media in such a situation, because, or hippies buffered, where you just put the sample there, you make one drop of PVP and above that you can have one of host. And can you select your sperms like that?
Yeah, yeah. And we are... But not just hippies media, we make it hypotonic by adding some water to it.
Yeah.
So one drop of water and one drop of media. And then if we have curling, then that helps.
All right. Charu ma'am, your case now.
So I think we have covered male and female counterpart, and another area of concern for male counterpart is sperm DNA fragmentation. So this is a case of 28 years old female, a good responder, having a history of one miscarriage. And the male counterpart is oligoacinetoteratospermia with high sperm DNA fragmentation. So I would like to ask Dr. Gaurav that what should be done for men with high sperm DNA fragmentation? What is your procedure or protocol to handle such kind of clinically as well as in embryological lab?
All right. So I'm actually the wrong person to ask about sperm DNA fragmentation.
That's why this question has been put to you.
Because I am
put the right perspective.
I am a huge skeptic when it comes to this, but I will still give you a well-rounded answer for this. A, for patients of ours who have high DNA fragmentation, it depends how high it is. If it is borderline or if it is above the, generally the threshold which is accepted is 25 or 30%, then just having a repeat sample, repeat ejaculation, successive repeat ejaculation will do the trick. And there are now many papers which have demonstrated that a successive ejaculation for 2 to 3 days, once daily, before the final ejaculation on the day of oocyte pickup, will drastically bring down the DNA fragmentation level. So problem solved, right? If the DNA fragmentation, high fragmentation levels still persist, if they were abnormally high to start with, then, because still, you know, the history is one miscarriage. So we cannot blame it on the DNA fragmentation. If there was a history of 3 miscarriages or 4 miscarriages, then probably we would have thought that, okay, it is essential to deal with the DNA fragmentation here. And then we would employ any sperm selection technique which would allow us to reduce the DNA fragmentation. Mind you, this is something that people overlook, that doing a density gradient centrifugation followed by a swim up also drastically brings down the percentage of fragmented sperm in a sample. So, but for everyone's sake, we can use PXE or MAX or microfluidic sperm preparation, and there we can surely then, you know, deal with the problem of fragmentation.
So truly said, I would ask Dr. Vandana, is she there? Okay, Dr. Priya, you can answer that if in man with a high DNA fragmentation, do you prefer antioxidant therapy or you just take it for the IVF cycle? And if so, what kind of treatment you would like to, clinically, how do you handle the man with a high DNA fragmentation?
Okay, in this particular case, he's got a high DNA fragmentation index, but his count and everything else is okay, right?
He's
I missed the clinical part. Okay, so he's severe OAT. So obviously, I will look into his lifestyle parameters and I will look for an SCSA. We do SCSA a lot here. So I would go by that and definitely put him on supplements. I'm sorry, as a clinical side, we always write supplements and prepare him before taking him up for an IVF, and surely an IVF, of course. In severe OATs, it's going to be an IVF, moderate to severe also. So I do believe in lifestyle changes. I do believe in supplementation. And like Gaurav said, I will agree on all the lab factors. So we do the SCSA, and based on the SCSA result, we choose the sperm preparation method. So if it's fair to poor and very poor DNA integrity that shows up on the SCSA, then microfluidics or even, double density gradient is good old method, time-tested method, but microfluidics and maybe allow sperm selection using sperm slow. So, you could do both these methods to get equivalent results. There's no one advantage of one over the other. That's what we actually presented, MFSS and sperm slow.
Dr. Alex, I want to ask you one question, that if man with a borderline sperm DNA fragmentation with normozoospermia, and if the sperm is treated with a sperm selection method like MAX or microfluidics, do you prefer ICSI for all or you should go for conventional IVF also? You should unmute yourself. We cannot hear you.
We could do half and half, half ICSI, half IVF.
Yeah, maybe that would be, because the natural selection might help. Because the zona pellucida is one of the good barrier for the sperm selection. And the second thing is, since we are talking about the DNA fragmentation, there are two types of DNA fragmentation. One is double-stranded and the single-stranded. I think because there is a lot of controversy regarding the miscarriage and everything, maybe the way we do it, the technology. So I think the double-stranded DNA damage is one of the major cause of the outcome. So I think that need to be considered. I think that's important.
Do they give us that information in SCSA analysis?
I think SCSA basically acrid orange stacking into the DNA strands. So I think she gives only the single strand. I think the alkaline chromatase and maybe the SCD, I think is SCD, sperm chromatin dispersion, that gives the detail about the double stranded break. I'm not sure about it. I think so.
Your actually PXE also works quite well. The physiological ICSI, that also works well with the
sperm flow that you mentioned is similar to PXE, right? It's the same principle.
It's the same phenomenon. We're coming to those strategies to reduce sperm DNA damage. Charu ma'am, there are so many strategies which exist.
Yes.
Like Gaurav mentioned, serial ejaculation, testicular sperm, there are so many things.
Yeah.
So rightly was told by our panelists that you know, short term ejaculation means frequency of ejaculation can reduce the sperm DNA fragmentation. So we can ask men when the lady is under stimulation that she has to ejaculate daily, and that can be done if it's borderline, and then can be prepared with the max or something. But if the sperm DNA fragmentation is high, I think TISA gives the good result in terms of the good take-home baby rates, because it is not only the blastocyst rate, it is ultimately, and I have a study that it reduces the miscarriages. Of course, blastocyst formation rate with the TISA is compared to ejaculate sample is less, but ultimately if you see the miscarriage rate, it is very less if you directly take the sperm from the testis, from the production site. And Dr. Sanders-Streves has lots of paper on this, and this is one of the paper where it says that 79.7% of DNA fragmentation is reduced if you use the testicular sperm in case of the man with the high DNA fragmentation. As we are also discuss about IMC, because it is higher magnification, and sperm head, if it is evacuated, if it is covered more than 50% of the head, definitely it is related with the sperm like DNA fragmentation. So if the vacuum vacuus is high, covering 50% of the head, then that sperm should be avoided for injection. So that is advantage of IMC if someone has in the lab.
Anyone has any experience with IMC?
No, none at all.
Anyone recommending IMC?
I don't find it an advantage. IMC, no. IMC is any great advantage compared to
I think that's what the Cochrane review, which has come out very recently.
I don't think it really...
It's really not shown any benefit, except for maybe very severe teratozoospermia, it might be used. But in cases of DFI, I'm really not sure whether it has shown any benefit.
See, suppose you're having a very poor sample, and then you're going to score out most of it if you do an IMC. That's where PICSI, a physiological selection, will come in
better.
So that's
the looks better.
Yeah. Okay, so since you're talking about PICSI, why don't you go ahead and explain a little bit about it?
Who are we talking to? Me?
Who are you talking to?
Both of you, any of you. All of you.
Very brief thing I'll tell you, because between PICSI dishes and the sperm slow, we use more of sperm slow in our lab. So hyaluronin-based sperm binding, and I'm sure Dr. Shubhangi will be a better person to get into more details, a better language. But just to tell the experience, if you have a sample where the morphology is also hit, it's better to go for a hyaluronin binding method of sperm selection, because then you're not biased and you know that there is it's intact. So in that way, it works better. But Dr. Shubhangi can go into the embryological...
Sure.
No, very in very, very simple words, I would say the sperms which are attached are the sperms which I'm going to pick up. That's the only rationale that I use when I'm using a PICSI dish. So the basic principle is the same, hyaluronon binding, and that the sperm head will have a normal DNA and less fragmentation. That's it.
But do you have any sibling who said comparative study with the PICSI and normal ICSI?
No. I have, in PICSI, I've only done PICSI. I have not done any sibling who said studies.
Okay. That's why it's a very...
I'm sorry.
But it has been shown.
It works definitely. Proven. It works wonders.
It has been proven through a multicentric randomized control trial, and that to a huge one. That for patients where the hyaluronin binding assay is poor, where less than 65% sperms bind to hyaluronin, their PICC brings down the pregnancy loss rate statistically, significantly.
Yeah, and that's in the latest Cochrane review as well.
And also in the that slide that was shown about the meta-analysis of Dr. Sandra Easterwood, I think a few slides before, regard the test TXC for the high DFI. And the same meta-analysis here shown that the they compared between a test TXC, IMC, and PIXC.
Okay.
In the test TXC, they got around 49.8% live birth. And in the PIXC, they got around 38% live birth. And in the IMC, it was something around 28% live birth in high DFI. So I think that study, I think that was a good meta-analysis. So that was showing a upper hand of the the high DFI cases.
So anyone has an experience of DFI value, comparative DFI value before and after the sperm preparation by this specific microfluidics or max or something? Does it really reduce the DFI?
No. I'm sorry.
We don't know about the DFI values, but we have used microfluidic chips and we found no difference in the outcomes. So we also published, we wrote a paper recently, one of our fellows did, and they did a proper prospective randomized study for about a year, but no difference.
Yeah, I've also had the same outcomes. Sadly, no difference in outcomes with microfluidics. Though I've seen a lot of clinics say that they've had an increased live birth rate, but we've not had any of those outcomes in our clinic as well.
Anyone has experience with another microfluidics which gives a better volume and can be injected for IUI also with the borderline sperm DNA giving a better result in the IUI?
I think Dr. KD Nair is there. I think they did some study on this microfluidic chip. I think Dr. KD Nair can comment on. Dr. KD is there, I think. He's there. Yes.
Wait.
Yes, sir, please.
We have used it for IVF. We are not used for IUI.
Okay.
We are
used for IVF. No, for IVF also, what is...
Everybody has his own finding. We found it to be a better modality of sperm preparation.
Okay.
It will definitely improve the DNA fragmentation function in this prepared sperm.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So that was the advantage.
Okay.
In fact, we are now submitting another paper comparing microfluidic with PIXC.
Okay.
We have submitted it for Asher. We'll see what happened. Mm-hmm. Comparing microfluidic with PIXC.
Thank you, KD, sir.
Supplier.
Keshav, can I chip in?
Yes.
Sanjay. Yes, sir. Please.
It is regarding test TXC. So I believe it may be helpful only if the DFIs due to post-testicular damage. It may not be helpful in pre-testicular things. So if it is already there, and another thing is if it is single-stranded DNA fragmentation, if the female partner is young, so the oocytes can themselves correct the single-stranded DNA for large extent.
Sanjay, sir.
Yes.
How do we test for like?
I wonder that.
Do we think that like a seminal ROS might be a marker in this scenario?
Maybe, and in adjunct with the oxidation reduction potential.
Okay.
So it's not just the oxidative stress.
I want to make one comment to Alex. And Alex, since you have done a lot of this testy ICSI, and one of your fellows presented your work in the recent conference. So I was the judge there, and I gave her a very hard time, the poor student. So I would, but despite that, we gave her a prize. So why don't you, since you do so much of STXC, and maybe nobody else in this country does so, you guys do a lot of testicular biopsies for such patients.
See, I have to give a comment here. That was the study, the retrospective study.
Because yeah,
now we are not doing that much of a STC. Okay.
So I wanted to say, why don't you do a prospective study, you know, to get good quality data?
The reason is that actually our male side patients are being seen by the male infertility specialist, uroandrologist, and he decides what to do on the depending on the DFI stage. So initially, we were doing I think the recent paper maybe that you had judged is that is in the, along the line of calcianophore, not related to the.
Oh yeah. But no, I remember because there was a sizable group of patients who underwent test TXC.
Yeah, that was some time back. Not we don't do that.
Okay.
Alex, sir, we are going to come to the calcium ionophore stuff as well. And I think Gaurav will ask that question again based on calcium ionophore. Yeah. Let's move on to the last part, which is Max. I think we've not touched Max. Anyone here using Max? And Charu, yeah. Ma'am, your experience also with this?
I'm using Max and... but the thing is comparative, yeah, pregnancy rate, it is fine, but I didn't compare the DFI before and after the Max. So in that way, the comparison study is not done, but of course it has bit improved the pregnancy rate.
Any other propagators of Max?
Yeah, we are using.
Have no experience.
Yeah. We are using a Max as one of the, because the reason is that in IVF, like in ICSI, when you sit in front of the ICSI microscope, it is the good-looking sperm we try to pick up. And in the Max, the thing is that it is a kind of a molecular filtration. The apoptotic sperm are getting removed in the andrology lab or by the person. So I think a good amount of apoptotic sperms are getting removed by this. And also I have seen that you get a good morphology after the Max preparation. So these are the few things that we have incorporated.
So that is a good point. We can do the at least morphology before and after the Max.
We have noticed that through microfluidic sperm separation, especially for suboptimal parameters like oligozoospermic samples, the morphology is quite poor. You know, often... poor morphology sperms will creep into that channel, which is
especially the sperm way. With a small head. With a small head will go fast and we can call like a worker sperm kind of thing.
Yeah.
Okay, we're moving on to the next question now. I think we've discussed a little bit about the sperm. So this is. A case where you have a young couple in their 30s who are visiting the fertility clinic for the first time with a history of one abortion 3 years back, very keen to become pregnant, otherwise very cooperative and calm. Stenoteratozoospermia, want to go ahead with the IVF ICSI cycles. Now, the in-house embryologist is not there, so you're getting a flying-in embryologist. So now, in such a scenario, what are the different parameters that the visiting embryologist must really look into, especially as far as the lab is concerned? And do we really feel that how important is I know lab is very, very important, but how important is to know about all the different parameters of the lab before you visit for doing such cases?
Okay.
Alex sir and Shubhangi also I'm going to bring in here.
See, the first question is that you have to make sure that you have a trained junior or embryologist in that particular center. But that is one of the big issues in many batch IVF centers in the country. The second, as you have given here, there are so many parameters need to be controlled. And the first and foremost is the quality and the environment of your incubator, whether it is correctly set. The CO2 and the cylinder, whether it has been properly, because in many of the batch centers, they work for maybe once in 2 months or something like that. So they shut down the incubators. So one has to be very careful about that aspect. What I have seen in many batch centers, they do well, consistently doing well if they bring in a company engineer from time to time before the batch. rather than you have an in-house person looking into all the physical parameters. Those person will come in maybe 1 week beforehand to do the things. I think that I have seen very, they are giving consistent results. So these are some of the take-home messages.
Shubhangi, would you want an in-house person or would you rely upon the visiting engineer?
Both, actually.
Yeah.
But I would like to get in the engineer 1 day before, not 8 days before the pickup. I mean, before the batch, you know. Just 1 day before, and he sets the incubators, checks the pH, checks the CO2, checks the temperatures, basic temperature checks of all working platforms, laminar hoods and ICSI and everything, and basic CO2 of incubator, working incubator and culture incubator. So if you have two incubators in that case. And also I would, the junior person who is over there in-house, like Alex said, he has to be trained. You cannot not train him, you know. He should know the basics, the checklist. This is working properly, that is working properly. You know, you have media, you have dishes, you have needles, you have pipettes. Every single thing, that SOP has to be there in place, wherever, whether you're doing it in batch or whether you have an in-house embryologist. So SOPs, according to me, are mandatory. They are very important. And so that anybody who takes over and in absence of the working person should not be hurdled, you know, he can have a smooth functioning. So the junior person needs to be trained definitely 100%. But engineer, I will like to take him with me or 1 day before and get all the instruments checked.
Okay.
The medias, mainly the media also.
I'm going to follow up the same question to you only. As far as poor embryo morphology is concerned and as far as failed IVF is concerned, which is our panel today, do you feel that these factors, like whenever you have a failure, what are the different factors that you would want to go back and check?
You would want to check each and everything. Clinically, the clinician will check the
parameters then.
Not the 200 parameters, but basic sperm, egg, and embryology lab. These three things I will 100% check.
For each and every
how the culturing was. Yes, okay. I would. Otherwise, we will not come to any results. You know, the troubleshooting is going to be by checking these things. How the oocytes were, how the, most importantly, the culturing of the embryos. How was the culturing done? How was the handling? Whether sterile, aseptic conditions were maintained? These things are very important. And small, small things like whether you are wearing gloves, whether you are wearing a mask. So these things also definitely, how were you scanning the oocytes, whether in an open center well dish or the center well dish was layered with oil in the moat and in the center well. So these things also definitely give a lot of difference in your outcomes, you know, a significant difference I have seen.
Gaurav and Priya, I'm going to bring you in for this slide. Now, there are a lot of factors. I love this slide from Charu ma'am because it's signifying the factors which are in direct contact, indirect contact, and also all our equipment. So what do you feel is, like, what's your sequence to check whenever there's any kind of a abnormal outcome that you're seeing in your laboratory?
Yeah, so that's important. An abnormal outcome in the laboratory, which means it is affecting all the patients. It is not individual patients who are, so if there is out of a group of patients, if one patient doesn't do well, that is not reflective of the laboratory conditions. Only if all patients, you know, given in a given time period start showing poor outcome, that's when you think that there's something wrong with the culture system. So this is very important. For individual cases, you don't do this exercise, right? It's a comparative analysis always. It is not individual because the cultures system and the culture space is common for all patients. It's the common gas, it's mostly common, you know. And in case if it's a collective failure, then definitely for us it is the gas which is indirectly determining the pH, and it is the culture media.
Priya,
the only two variables that are constantly changing very rapidly throughout the year, the temperature and the humidity and the VOC levels tend to remain more or less stable. We will check those also, but these are my most two important variables.
Agree.
Priya? I completely agree with Gaurav. And if I'm a clinician sitting and then I find this batch failure, and the first thought that will go is, what about the media? You know, that's the scariest part, the culture media. And then, of course, like he rightly said, it's our gases. These two are the most, you know, and also the oil. I wanted to mention that there have been issues with oil the last couple of months in our group discussion. So I think these three are very, very important. And this is what even the mind would go to and think, okay, we'll have to recheck everything now. Because like he rightly said, a single failure doesn't determine. It's the whole batch, that whole crop. Why is it happening in spite of, you know, other factors being, you know, negated, like a female factor or male factor or, you know, your protocol, stimulation protocols. This is the...
Yeah, I have a question from Bindu, ma'am, and I'll ask Alexa to actually address it. She's saying that what about the use of over-equilibrated media or your leftover media, which is in the incubator? Like, till when can you use it? Like, do you want to use it even after 1 or 2 days of equilibration? Because it should be okay for
the
5 days.
The first and foremost thing is that the thing is that the equilibration means, I don't know how it has been equilibrated, is in a tube or in the bottle. That practice should not be there. The first and foremost one should make the dishes itself. And if you have any kind of a tubes with a media equilibrated, that should only be used for maybe during the pickup time, only for the washing purpose, not for the long-term culture of the gametes or the embryos. Yeah. And also, I think there is a practice of keeping the oil for a long time. I think that is also not a good practice.
I also have a question for Dr. Alex. That generally that cylinder, gas cylinder people gives us a purity certificate.
Yeah.
But do we only have to rely on that, or is there any external third parties where we can test the gas supplied by our supplier?
See, you well know that the most of the problem for the early miscarriages in many of the centers is due to the gas quality. Because we don't have any medical gradation in India. Only few companies are giving the high purity, so-called high purity gases. Even I have some experience 10 years back on center having the first batch. It was totally washed out. Because they used the local carbon dioxide in a big box incubator. And they, unfortunately, they didn't put the inline filter there. And also some people have the obsession of using too much disinfectant. They had used the isopropyl alcohol to clean the whole wall and everything. And the poor boy, the OT boy, had an allergic reaction on his hand after that incident. So I think so many things need to be controlled, especially the gas quality need to be controlled. I think that is, as Gaurav has mentioned, these two. And also the training, proper training of the staff in the clinic. They also can spell disaster for any kind of a thing is not done properly, especially the dish preparation. Yeah, I just forget to tell Charu that there are external what you can do, because
I will like to add
certificate of analysis. Certificate of analysis, like in India, if you tell them, they will write like that, whatever you tell them. That is, I have seen with some gas companies. So maybe you can aspirate the gas and you can give it to some testing agency. They can test it by GLC or HPLC method. So they will tell you exactly what is the impurities present in that.
Thank you, sir. Shubhangi, very quickly and very briefly, and then we move on to the next one.
Yeah, the thing is, media in the incubator, I don't see any difference or any negative impact on the embryo development if the media is kept for around 3 to 4 days. Absolutely no. That's quite fine. I mean, that is a principle. When you use a time lapse, you're supposed to keep it uninterrupted, right? So if the media is kept in the incubator for 4 days and used, I don't think it should have any negative outcome on
differ, because now recently even Vitrolife media, they have now given a specification with their media that not to be used beyond 3 days, no matter what. So we follow that. And because
3 to 4 days is quite okay, I feel. It doesn't matter.
Constantly, you know, there's a buildup of ammonia. And there's lots of other stuff which is happening, you know. The antibiotics are getting degraded and so on and so forth.
I personally don't like it unless and until it's a very emergency situation, which rarely happens.
I want to know that you are talking about that one step media, not about the sequential media, na?
Yes. No, for one step. Yeah.
One step only, na? Then it's okay. Na? Otherwise, it will hamper the, I think, outcome also. If you keep the fertilization or cleavage media for than 3-4 days.
Absolutely.
Okay, Charu ma'am, let's move forward. We're running short of time. We have 2 more questions.
Yeah, so there is another case which is very interesting, that one couple who has a failed ICSI cycle, and when they are looking for the reason, they found that there is a poor fertilization rate in spite of doing the ICSI and the poor embryo quality. The couple wants to go ahead with the second attempt, but they have frozen the eggs with some other clinic and they came with their frozen eggs. So what are the, you know, parameters to be considered for such case, and how to go ahead with this couple for the next second IVF cycle? Shubhangi, go ahead.
Okay. If you have frozen oocytes, thawing is important. So what we follow is thaw the oocytes and keep them for around 2 hours and then perform ICSI, and it gives very good results. So that is a standard protocol. For at least 2 hours, I will keep the oocytes after thawing and then I will do the ICSI.
That is true. So what are the other parameters you're looking for, the poor fertilization and poor outcome for the first cycle? The other things to be checked?
I have a question. Why is it frozen oocytes? He's got severe teratozoospermia.
Yeah.
Man, why are we talking about frozen oocytes? I mean, why were eggs frozen and why was sort of...
Can we go back to the question?
Just one rare scenario.
It is what the clinic wanted to do at that time.
Yeah, exactly.
It's kind of rarest of rare cases.
maybe they couldn't find like morphologically normal sperms, and they injected the ones they could find, and the rest of the eggs they froze. Okay. It could be that kind of a scenario.
Because the treatment for severe teratozoospermia, then it all boils down to that. No, what is your? Because I was wondering why we are again and again going to freeze oocytes instead of actually thinking how to select the sperms. Anyhow, no, I'm sorry, because I was just.
So in this case, then one would think that since with the poor morphology sperm in the first go, with even with fresh eggs, the fertilization was poor. Mm. So we better take measures like calcium ionophore or something to boost the chances in this cycle. But then a big setback is the frozen oocytes.
Yeah.
So you feel that calcium ionophore is required for a reason of frozen oocytes and the teratozoospermia?
Not for frozen oocyte, but for teratozoospermia, since you've mentioned that in the first go, there was very poor fertilization with the sperm. So second time around, we can try with calcium ionophore. Even though, you know, poor fertilization maybe doesn't mandate the use. If there was no fertilization, then 100% we would have used.
Right.
Maybe first and foremost, this patient should be treated for the reason, that is the teratozoospermia, by the management. I think that is the first and foremost. Then, like if you want to go for the calcium or for the problem, as Gaurav has mentioned, the frozen oocyte will degenerate when you put in the calcium for because it is a viscous thing. So maybe you should, if you have no other options, so if you want to go with that strategy, maybe first you inject and see how is the pattern of the injection, whether it is getting, how is the membrane fluidity and membrane elasticity. If you are happy with that, and if you have enough number of oocytes, maybe you can go ahead with the calcium, or if there is no other options.
Yeah.
Do we still feel that frozen eggs are not equal to fresh eggs? Mm-hmm.
Because that depends on the proficiency of the senders, the how they do it. So I think that has to be taken care of. If it is a standardized sender, I think there is no issue.
Yeah, because I do a lot of egg freezing, and like most of our donor cycles are also frozen eggs. And I really don't see that difference. So honestly speaking, I would not be worried if I'm freezing eggs, but other panelists are welcome to put in their comments.
I still feel like how Dr. Alex mentioned, it has a lot to do with the elasticity and, you know, how the morphology of the oocyte is after freezing. So because we are dealing with referral cases a lot now, because there are so many other centers that can take care of virgin cases, our practice where egg freezing is concerned is only restricted to where there is no sperm available on that day or... So in that aspect, I feel a lot has to do with the what kind of oocytes are presented to you for oocyte freezing in the first place. You know, because even not all donors, most of these donors come after, you know, tubal sterilization and things. So I won't harp too much on donors giving you the best quality for you to be able to retrieve. But this is, again, center to center variation and practice and debates. So it's great if you're having, you know, the same results. But I would have to say that my results will
We are worried, hugely worried.
I'm usually worried. I always say,
we have good results with frozen oocytes.
Okay. I would be worried.
Okay.
But, in this list, if you see for teratozoospermia and things, I think surgical sperm, is anyone for surgical sperm? And
this is a list of indications which have been tried, like AOA for these list of indications. We necessarily don't agree upon it. So what would be your like sure shot scenario of using artificial oocyte activation? There have been case reports of all of these indications.
Previous TFF. Previous TFF and globozoospermia.
True, because where is there a PLC zeta deficiency will be there in the globozoospermia. So it is definitely helpful for the globozoospermia.
We have never used calcium ionophore in our lives for surgical sperm or for frozen thawed sperm, never in ever.
I've only used it once, and that was globozoospermia, and that's it. No other.
We use it routinely for total fertilization failures.
Correct.
For ICSI total fertilization failure, not IV. Right.
So we'll can I comment?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So we are using it for the surgical retrieved cases or sperms having morphological issues, because one of the major issue, you know, that phospholipase zeta, the level, you still don't know how much is there, because the level of phospholipase can impact on the calcium oscillation once fertilization happens and the later development. So that's the reason why we have started using this for surgical retrieved. And recently we are submitted to Shrey also, a controlled study, one of our fellow. And we have seen, we looked at the cumulative live birth rate, and we have seen improvement in the non-obstructive oesospermia, not in the obstructive cases, in the non-obstructive oesospermia cases in the micro-TSA and the TSA non-obstructive oesospermia and the testy ICSI cases, not in the obstructive oesospermia cases. So that means maybe what we can infer from there, maybe that hormonal problem in the non-obstructive oesospermia is affecting the molecular architecture of the sperm at the level of phospholipase zeta, that may be in the downstream, may be affecting that the calcium oscillation. So when we add this thing, maybe that is giving some kind of a surrogate kind of a effect. Yeah.
Alex, have you used?
I have a question from Neil. She has seen an observation abroad where they've actually put calcium ionophore in PVP and then used it for ICSI. I've never heard of such a practice. Anyone?
No.
Recently you must have seen that in the fertility sterility, that Palermo group in Cornell, they have published a fantastic paper looking at, they even injected the,
yes,
the calcium, yeah, for inside the oocyte in the, they, yeah, divided the cases, the previous failed fertilization care in the two groups, and they categorized into female factor or the male factor. They actually checked the phospholipase zeta level. I think they had some kind of a kit, a monoclonal antibody, something. They checked the phospholipase zeta level in the sperm of the patient. Then they categorized. Maybe in a, you know, sometime, maybe you will get
and, the and
we have done this. We have injected calcium ionophore inside the oocyte. We have done this because nothing else seemed to be working, and we've read about this.
Okay.
Where they've actually started injecting calcium ionophore inside oocytes in their bid to achieve fertilization. Unfortunately,
I was reading about recombinant PLC zeta coming up.
Exactly, it is there. It's the next. I think we'll have that.
I think I removed those slides because they were getting too long. We can take the last question, and this is directed for all of you, and this is for basically all the recent advances that are there. So your experience with time lapse in cases where there was poor embryo morphology or IVF failure, anyone here who's using time lapse?
We are using in our Canadian clinic from 2017, that Jury Plus. So until then, we were kind of every day we were taking out the embryos until day 5-6 and do the morphology scoring. What we have seen interestingly is that the trophoctet morphology has become better, I think, when we started culturing all patients in this one. And also, even though we haven't seen a real, we compared between the benchtop planar incubator humidified along with the jury, and we have seen some improvement in the live birth and this, but that was not really statistically significant.
And what about this coming new non-invasive screening like metabolomics and all that instead of PGT? Will it be improve our embryo selection?
Even non-invasive chromosomal screening is coming up. Gaurav, your thoughts on it? You do a lot of PGT.
It would be great. I mean, only if, because we'll get rid of the invasive biopsy steps, but we don't yet know how effective it is. We've never tried it, and we need more data on the efficacy of NIPGT.
Priya,
So we did the initial, we were asked to submit 10, no? We always have to have, before you implement it in practice, we are tested, right? So we didn't get the concordance, though we thought we followed all the rules and regulations of NIPT. It did not happen, ANACE. And so the thing is, I still am partial to my PGTA. And remember the last, one of the previous meetings, we were having this discussion, is it okay to culture until day 7? And, is that going to be the new norm? And I'm still jittery on that front. So if I get a well-expanded blast on day 5 and day 6, I'm already itching to do invasive testing rather than wait, until day 7 for all the metabolomics to happen and for us to test the fluid and everything. I didn't get my concordance which they wanted. So I have to redo the whole exercise now again and submit 10 more samples before I'm certified. So
what kind of a concordance are we aiming for?
I think they wanted at least 84 or more.
And there's concordance with what?
With trophectoderm.
Trophectoderm. So you send the media sample, and then you also send the trophectoderm. So then you should have a concordance.
So how can you control that as a user?
No, I don't do anything. I send the samples, and then they read the samples and they tell me this one.
No, so if there's no concordance, if there is less concordance, it means that the test is inefficient.
Yes.
Or the amount of media has.
There was some problem. Probably maybe mine was contamination they spoke about.
Then they said it was inadequate sampling. So I need to work on that aspect.
There are a lot of things like the volume of the drop that you're culturing in, which can affect
size, and it's and your blasts also should grow to that extent until day 7 and things. So it's a lot of technicalities which are probably where we have to learn more.
I think recently on center was sued for this. They lost a lot of embryos because of the non-invasive testing strategy. They want us to, I think, be very careful, I think, when we introduce this new technology. Because I think day 3, you have to change the media.
Yes.
I think you have to change the... This way, they want us to be...
And very, very small. It's a microliter. Very, very little. You know, you have to culture it.
And microliter.
That makes the conventional biopsy sound so much simpler.
That's why I'm saying I'm still, partial to the invasive testing. Because really, really too precise. And even if you think you've done the best job, I mean, you know, I still haven't passed the test. So there you go.
Anyone wants to comment on MITOSCORE and like choosing or prioritizing embryos based on MITOSCORE? Shubhangi?
I have not personally done it. Only theoretical knowledge. So I don't think I'm the right person to be answering this. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I also, I don't have experience with MITOSCORE. Gaurav, you?
Yeah.
They do report a MITOSCORE for every PGT embryo.
PGT, yes. But that's what I've seen.
We rank the embryos on the basis of morphology.
Yeah.
Not MITOSCORE.
Okay. If it happens to be good that both are coinciding, that is good for us. But otherwise, we always write a disclaimer. No, they'll say clinicians, embryologists, you please look at the morphology and then go by our MITOSCORE.
And even they themselves are not. They don't have evidence that MITOSCORE ranks higher than morphology.
Okay, I'm skipping a few slides because we are running short of time. Cochrane came up with this analysis. I think the recent analysis on adherence compounds, especially hyaluronan, embryo glue. Do you want to use that in cases of implantation failure?
We had used it a few years back, the embryo glue, when it was a real big thing, you know.
But now but I don't see it.
I don't see any difference.
I've got really bad reports and I have zero experience. And I have intention of bringing
we have used it in few patients, but with no difference in the outcomes.
GM-CSF?
Yes, that we are using for a lot of patients and that we are getting a good result.
What about antioxidants in media?
No experience, sorry.
There's new media coming up in India as well, like
the GX series.
GX series. It's. I think they're doing trials in India. I'm trying it out.
Get rid of max and microfluidics and all that.
Yeah, I'm trying it out. Now I've not seen any difference. But anyone else?
Recently, in a webinar, a lot of data was presented for this media by the Japanese Society.
Yeah.
Of reproduction. And they were speaking very highly of it.
Yeah, that's true. I've done like 12 cases so far. I've not, and it's a sibling study that we're doing, and I have not seen the kind of difference that was being reported in that Japanese webinar. But hoping that things improve. Charu ma'am, let's conclude.
Keshav, just one comment.
Yeah, sir.
What I am worried about all these additives is the epigenetic effect that might be translated later in life.
Absolutely.
So we need a very robust studies before we implement into our day-to-day practice.
And very robust consents with patients.
Exactly.
They should also know the kind of things that are being tried out.
That's right.
And like for each and every add-on, like we've emphasized it since like 2019 with ISAR, that for each and every add-on, you should be taking a good consent because we don't know what might happen to the kid in the future. So at least that kind of a safeguard should be there.
So as lots of advances is happening and change is inevitable, you know, a change is only constant thing. So we have to incorporate good change if it is for the better outcome. But as Dr. Keshav said and Dr. Sanjay said, that we have to be very cautious. We have to take the consents, proper consents, and then only use necessary treatments or add-ons for the specific group of patients where it is really going to make the difference. That's what I feel. And embryo development and embryo outcome is not only depending upon the lab factor, but we need to, you know, prepare the source. Like, we need to prepare the man and the woman for the better quality of the gametes, improved medications, improved IVF techniques, improved lab culture conditions, and that will all will, you know, give the better outcome. And we should, you know, we should not miss the proper signal. We should have the, all the parameters to look into for our good lab and good outcome. That's what I think this mantra should be.
Absolutely, ma'am. Thank you for summing it up really well. Ved sir, we have a few questions.
Yes.
We have time to take them, or
you can take. There is no.
Okay, so this might be just a revision. These are questions that we've not answered, so anyone can pitch in. We have a question from Sanjay sir. Would you like to inject an egg through the SER?
No.
Oh. Okay. Harendra is asking, which method can be used for high DFI for better embryo quality, SCPD, I don't know what that is, or microfluidics? So I think it's density gradient or microfluidics.
Density gradient is, for me, the best gold standard method, density gradient and swim up. If you don't have anything else, do that. You are definitely going to get very good embryos.
Okay. Priya, when should we go for a DFI?
When should we
go for a DFI test?
So in our practice, when the couple comes in and if they've had even failed IUIs outside, I actually ask for a SCSA testing, because I'll have to determine, you know, how many more cycles I can have a go at it before taking them for an ART or a repeat IUI cycles with us. Second thing is, most of my ART patients, especially ones with previous failures outside, all get SCSA done, like a general rule. I have to be truthful, so I'm saying that.
Bindu ma'am is asking these questions. If PLC zeta, this is, I think, when we were talking about the estimation of phospholipase zeta. So if PLC zeta was estimated in the sperm, how was that sperm used? What was the estimation? Was the estimation done by a non-destructive method, Alex, sir?
It is clear. It is given. I think they have used, I am not sure exactly the amount of the PLC zeta they got, but compared to the fertile, I think, and those patients had less amount of PLC zeta level in those sperms in that particular patient. So that's why they went ahead with the two technique. I think one was invasive and one was kind of putting the calcium for in the after the ICSI. Other they were injecting both inside.
Shubhangi, the next question, I'll put it to you. GM-CSF acts via receptors, so it shouldn't logically be improving the embryo.
No comments. It is just an observation. So we just still concluding. So there is no concrete result as such. But we've observed that the results are definitely better, I would say. So it's still under study.
I think there are a lot of questions on PLC zeta. I think, Ved sir, the next webinar, you can have a session on PLC zeta itself.
Yeah, I think so. So you have to moderate that.
Okay, everyone. Thank you so much. And thank you to iHERA for inviting us all here.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Our media partner today, Mr. Deepak Mishra, for giving us support.
Thank you. Dr. Charu.
Thank you, everybody.
Dr. Charu, are you there?
Dr. Charu Dutt Joshi or Dr.?
Dr. Charu Dutt Joshi, sorry.
Sir is on mute, he is there.
Dr. Charudhar Joshi has...
I am very well here. I was just confirming whether it is me only or you are talking to Charulata.
Hello. Then start with note of
Dr. Time. Priya, are you there?
Yes.
Hi, nice to see you after a long time. Just wanted to say hello.
you know, today I have seen that we are all from the different parts of India. Today, mini India is there. South, North, East, West, everyone is here. In center also.
Great.
Lovely
discussion. Yeah.
Thank you. Charu,
please go for start.
And congratulations, Charu and Keshav. Wonderful session. Thank you very much, organizers and Ved.
Thank you.
So, three cheers for iHERA.
Yes.
So, on behalf of iHERA, I would like to thank all of you to spare your precious time and joining the meeting and enlightening us with your day-to-day experience and knowledge. So, with that, I would like to thank once again to each and everyone who participated in the webinar.
Thank you.
Thank you. Everyone.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you very much.
Thank you. You are looking great in your Himachali topi.
Wow. Thank you. I was very desperate to listen from someone. At least someone should comment on my head.
Sir, आपने अपना photo क्यों छुपा रखा है? आप भी अपने दर्शन करवा दो अब. हाँ, अब दर्शन हो गए और पीछे कोई और भी दर्शन दिखा रहा है.
या शी इज चवी
चवी वही मैं कह रहा हूँ. चलो थैंक यू बाय
होप टू मीट यू ऑल सून अगेन.
हाँ बिल्कुल
यस श्योर
बाय. सो चारू जी भाग्य चार कहाँ गया ये भाग्य. अच्छा हाँ जी थैंक यू चारू मैम थैंक यू सो मच. आप आ गए इतने शॉर्ट पीरियड नोटिस में ना. मैं तो सोच रहा था पता नहीं आपको कैसे कहूँ आप कैसे मुझे सुनाओगे कि बस लास्ट मोमेंट पे याद किया डॉक्टर.
हमारा तो क्या है अभी 20 साल का है कुछ स्लाइड इधर उधर ही करना होता है.
नहीं अच्छा हुआ ना अच्छा हुआ. मुझे लग रहा था मैंने कहा यार लास्ट मोमेंट में एक हफ्ता रह गया और एक हफ्ते पहले मैं बोल रहा हूँ.
नहीं, नहीं, नहीं वो एक ही दिन में कर दिया था सर क्योंकि केस